Welcome to Lindenwood Link Sports, live on LBTV. Welcome to Lindenwood Link Sports, live on LBTV. Welcome. Welcome to Lindenwood Link Sports, live on LBTV. Welcome to Lindenwood Link Sports. Welcome to Lindenwood Link Sports, live on LBTV.
And we have the third. St. Francis, where is he?
know the Cougars can do what they can, and they put up big points on the board, big runs, big drives, and we should see a lot of this here today.
Well, you're absolutely right, Sean. And when you look at St. Francis's, you know, previous games this season, they've been putting up bunches of points quickly. And, you know, last week they beat Missouri Baptist 51-7, so they don't waste time.
We welcome those joining us from the broadcast on LBTV as well, as quarterback throws out to his right side, and it is caught, but it's going to be taken for a loss of a few yards. A few yards will be gained, but could have had a lot more after the catch, but instead he ran back.
It was a good catch, though, Sean, by Dan Rixke.
Crable had a good throw. He had 2 men in the backfield as well as the clock continues to take it back. The clock has stopped running. I think it's an official's timeout right now. The official is congregating.
Yeah, I have a hard time believing we've only had 50 seconds go off the clock in this game.
There's a personal foul, face mask penalty on the Lynx, so it's half the distance to the goal, first down. That's why the clock stopped, and the Lynx already dealing themselves trouble that they just can't, quite frankly, can't afford to do in this game.
Yeah, Sean, and, you know, we saw that last week. They had a lot of 15-yard, you know, penalties, and that, you know, ended up hurting them on a couple drives that ended up stalling.
First and goal for Crable. He's got 1 man in the backfield, play action. He's looking for the end zone, rolling out to his right, toward the end zone, tipped out of the hands, incomplete. Intended receiver, number 5, Dylan Hundley.
That was Avery Andrews that broke it up. Good defensive play.
Indeedly so. That stops the clock. 13:52 to go. The Cougars in the red zone. It would be big for the Lynx to get a stop and force a field goal.
You're absolutely right, Sean.
Thank you, Chris.
And we saw this last week. You know, in the first quarter, the Lynx defense was able to hold Taylor University to a couple field goal tries early on in the game.
Split wide receivers on both sides. It's going to be a handoff up the middle and a big stop, maybe 1 yard gain, but a big stop by the Lynx defense there.
Looks like that was Hunter DeLones along with number 57, Christian Miller, both there on the stop.
On there for the run was P.J. Dean for the Cougars. He gained 2 yards on that run. It didn't seem like very much, to be perfectly honest. But no, empty backfield for Crable. Five wide receivers, 3 to the left. Crable looking to score. He's looking for the pass. Quick pass. No, he fakes. He goes, runs right up the middle toward, in the hole. Diving for the end zone. He won't get there. And the Lynx, a very big defensive stop. Now we'll see what St. Francis does here. They could go for it, but they might bring on the field goal unit. Crable staying on the field. They're going for it.
They are. But either way, if you're the Lynx defensive, good possession there to make a stop there to force a fourth down and make the St. Francis coaching staff think already here, you know, just 3 minutes into the game.
Some substitutions being made by the Cougars. It's a big fourth down here in the game. Here are 12:35 to go in the first quarter. 1 man in the backfield. We got a timeout by the Lynx taken here with 12:31 to go in this first quarter. So it is homecoming day for Lindenwood. If you're just joining us, Lindenwood University Belleville football team 0-8 wraps up its home portion of the 2018 season with the annual homecoming game against, obviously, the aforementioned University of St. Francis Cougars, who are 6-2 this season and still ranked number 9. They're back-to-back defending national champions. Along with it being homecoming game, the Lynx honored 10 of their seniors prior to the kickoff. Cougars are...
Well, and Sean, yeah, when you look at the Lynx remaining schedule, I mean, it really doesn't get any easier after this week because they ended the season against 2 more ranked opponents, both on the road at Siena Heights University, who's currently ranked 21st, and then at second-ranked Marion University to end the season.
Completely agree, and last week against the Taylor University Trojans, the Lynx did lose 28-19, but they had a lot of building, ground to build from, I should say, from that loss. But here we go. Fourth down, all the receivers to the right side, and a man in the backfield, that is P.J. Dean. The play action. Crable rolling out to his right, looking for the end zone. Easily, no coverage. Touchdown for the Cougars.
Yeah, Sean, I'm not sure if there was a blown coverage there, but there were two guys wide open in the end zone. He had number 11 all alone by himself, who ended up not getting the ball thrown to him, which was Will Chrisman, but he was able to find a guy wide open in the end zone. So 6-0 here for St. Francis, barring the extra point.
Jordan Cannon was the one that made the catch for the Cougars. So the fourth down pays off, and the Lynx unable to stop. The field goal is up, and the extra point up and away, and it is good. And so it's 7-0 in favor of the Cougars. Instead of taking a break here, we'll keep it locked right here. Give you a brief rundown of what is going on so far in this game. The Lynx moving from right to left in this football game on our beautiful field here at Lynx Stadium.
Tell you what, Sean, it's actually turned out to be a pretty nice day outside.
It certainly has. It's
especially for homecoming.
It has. Not a little bit of a breeze. Not shouldn't affect the kicking too much. The Lynx wearing their maroon uniforms with their black pants, the black helmet, and the white numbers. And the Francis Cougars, St. Francis Cougars, wearing their white uniforms, silver helmets, black pants, blue numbers. Kind of looks like a little bit latent to the Dallas Cowboys.
I'd say that's a pretty good comparison there, Sean.
Pretty good comparison, except for the black pants, but a little bit looks like them. But they're ready to kick off here with 12:26 to go in the first quarter.
Back deep to receive for the Lynx, number 5, Daquan Stewart, along with number 7, Ricardo Henry.
And kicking off for the Cougars on this kickoff, number 46.
Stewart's going to field a kick up the 10-yard line.
Sorry about that.
He's going to have a little bit of running room. He's going to get brought down just shy of the 25-yard line as he was tripped up by number 32 on St. Francis.
You want to take it from here, Chris? I know you've done most of the football games. This is my first one. You can take this offensive drive for the Lynx if you'd like.
Oh, I appreciate that, Sean.
No problem. I try to share the load.
The generosity these days. So the Lynx offense coming out into the field. 12:18 to go here in the first quarter. Lynx trailing 7-0. They will officially have the ball on their own 23-yard line. Chester and the Lynx offense out on the field. Chester awaiting the snaps. Got two receivers to his left, tailback to his left, and two receivers to his right. There's a snap. He's dropping back to pass. He's looking to his left. Pass is incomplete. It's actually intercepted, and St. Francis is going to take that to the house for a pick six as it was in and out of the hands of number 89. Justice Stubblefield.
Wilmer Cole with the interception for the Cougars. So one throw of the day for the Lynx, and it results in a pick six.
Tell you what, Sean, it wasn't a bad pass on Chester's part right there, just in and out of the hands, and an easy pick six for St. Francis. And going forward, Sean, you know, you have to be able to keep that offense on the field and minimize these turnovers against a really good team like St. Francis. So 13-0 here. St. Francis barring the extra point, number 87. Gavin Gardner out for the PAT. There's a snap. Kick is up. Kick is good. So it's going to be 14-0 St. Francis. With 12:09 to go here in the first quarter, we're going to take a quick commercial break here. More Lynx football when we return.
One of the new and exciting additions to the Lindenwood Belleville campus is the Major General William L. Enyard Veteran Success Center. There are over 100 VA students on the Belleville campus, and the Enyard Veteran Success Center provides a lounge and study space to meet and adjust to college life. It also has information about GI Bills, benefits, and available tuition assistance. It's a mini USO. For more information, call 618-239-6208 or visit belleville.lindenwood.edu.
And welcome back to Lindenwood Stadium here on the campus of Lindenwood Belleville, St. Francis, Indiana, leading the Lynx 14-0. Here's the kickoff. Lynx back to receive after the pick six. Kickoff's fielded by Ricardo Henry. He's out across the 20-yard line. He's going to get brought down after dragging a tackler out to about the 28-yard line.
Yeah, number 27, Damon Hunter, the freshman, was the one on the first tackle. I'm sure more players will get credit, but he was tracked for about, like you said, 10 or 5 yards or so.
So I tell you what, Sean, after that first possession by the Lynx, I mean, I'd be expecting a run here on the first play here after throwing a pick on the first one, just trying to get the offense gelling a little bit.
I would agree myself. There is one man in the backfield next to Chester's side on the right side, so we'll see what happens, and maybe even play action.
Looks like it's number 20, Jaquay Owens. And Jaquay Owens had a good game last week against Taylor University.
It's going to be a free play here for the Lynx. Hopefully they jumped offside.
Chester's pass is complete to number 10. That's Mitch Peters, and he's going to be close to a first down. Looks like it's going to be about 2 yards short, so it's going to be second and 2 after a gain of 8 on the play.
Surprisingly, there was no flag on the play, and I am, to be perfectly honest, quite surprised on that. The player for the Francis Cougars, St. Francis Cougars, clearly jumped offside. No flag was thrown.
Yeah, I saw exactly what you saw, Sean. Number 97, he was, looks like, clearly offside. Yeah, but either way, it's going to be a completion of 8 yards. There's a snap, handoff to Owens. He's going to run straight ahead, and he's going to be brought down, looks like, right at the sticks. So it's going to be, we're going to see what the refs give him there, see if he'll have enough. And it looks like they are signaling enough for a first down.
Yes, yep. So first down was at the 40-yard line, and they got it.
So first and 10 here for the Lynx, ball on their own 40-yard line. So we tick under 11 and a half minutes to go here in the first quarter. Chester's got two receivers to his left, Owens to his right, along two receivers to his right. There's a snap. Chester dropping back. He's looking across the middle, and he just overshoots number 7, Ricardo Henry, as he had a step on the defender there, Sean.
He did. He was in double coverage, and he had an opening. Tried to thread the needle with the pass. Just out of the reach. If just a little bit underthrown, he would have gotten the first down and then some. Probably would have been tackled after the catch, though, but it was nonetheless good effort with 11-10 here to go. Just got to be a little sharper on that one next time.
So the Lynx have 4 receivers into the game right now. 3 receivers split to the left. 1 to the right. The one alone is Mitch Peters. St. Francis looks like they're showing blitz, and it looks like they may have done enough to try to draw a false start on the Lynx there, Sean.
Yeah.
Hopefully I'm wrong, and they're going to call an approachment. So it is going to be a false start in the Lynx, so it's going to bring up 2nd and 15, so back up the Lynx onto their own 35-yard line.
The officials should know what kind of game this is going to be. They still haven't picked up the flag there on the 47-yard line. Now they have, but you have a team that's ranked number 9 in the nation, versus a team that's looking for their first win of the season. I mean,
so 2nd and 15 for the Lynx. Chester awaiting the snap. There's a snap. St. Francis showing blitz. Pass is complete to Candelaria. He's got some running room, and he's going to get most of that yardage back, which is going to make it a little bit more manageable. 3rd down here, is it's going to probably be a gain of,
looking at a gain of 9 or 10. It was a good catch for the Lynx. Good catch for number 13, like you said.
I'll tell you what, though, Sean. I mean, Chester had about no time to release that ball. I mean, he had a guy right in his face. The time he released that, he was already on the ground.
Yeah, he was did a very good job of avoiding getting rid of the ball quickly. So 3rd and 6 here for the Lynx.
St. Francis showing blitz again.
Oh.
Pass is complete to number 2. That's Jordan Flores, as he brought in with one hand, but it does look like he is going to be about a yard short of the first down there, Sean.
It was a good one-handed catch, like you said. Jordan Flores, you know, if he catches that without a hand, maybe he stays in bounds, but he had to jump back a little bit to get that ball.
He did. So right here, Sean, you know, just 5 minutes into the game, and the Lynx coaching staff had to make a big decision here. It's 4th and 1 on their own 49-yard line, trailing by 14.
Yeah, interim head coach for the Lynx. He's going for it here.
There's a snap. Hand off to Owens. He's going to go straight ahead, and he's not going to have the first down. So the Lynx are going to turn the ball over on downs, and St. Francis will take over in Lynx territory as they will have the ball on the Lynx.
Pat Stewart, the interim head coach, thought it would be a good idea there with a run play. And unfortunately for the Lynx, they're now 0-1 on fourth down conversions. And in a game where, you know, honestly, quite honestly, you can't afford mistakes.
You really can't, Sean.
Mm-mm. And we've already had, this is the, if you want to count the fourth down touchdown, this is the third mistake the Lynx have made.
So St. Francis back on offense. Quarterback dropping back to pass. He's looking downfield. And he's going to hop out of a sack, and he's going to throw it downfield, and the pass is incomplete, but there is a flag on the play, maybe a holding call.
I saw, I believe, a holding on the defense, but we'll see what happens. And that's exactly what it's going to be, a holding on the defense. Lynx catch a break there. If maybe they get the sack, maybe don't take the penalty, but
yeah,
this penalty moving back another 10 yards. So it'll be first and 20 now for the Lynx's number 70. For St. Francis, that's Anthony Smith, the freshman taking the penalty. So Lynx get some good fortune on that penalty now. We'll see if they can capitalize here defensively. It's Crable in the gun once again. Three receivers to his right side. He's looking over to his left and throws it to the halfback that was right next to him up the middle. They regain the 10 yards outside the numbers. He's looking to go in some more, and he possibly, yes, he will get the first down. A 20-yard catch after the, he probably got another 15 yards after the catch as well. So pushed out of bounds, and he moves the chains. They're going no huddle here.
Yeah, Crable's got two receivers to his left, one to the right. Hands the ball off. He's going to run straight forward, and he's going to go untouched until he gets past the first down marker.
P.J. Dean on that carry, the junior. He was the one that had the catch after the previous play. So before the previous play, rather.
So ninth-ranked St. Francis University out of Indiana driving down the field here as they are close to the red zone, ball on the 21-yard line. There's a snap. Crable fakes the handoff. Went out to his left. And it looks like he's going to get brought down inside the 5-yard line. Looked like that was number 57 for the Lynx, Christian Miller.
Yep, first and goal here for the Cougars, who are showing why they are the number one team, number nine ranked team in the nation, the two-time defending national champions.
But, Sean, they don't waste any time getting down the field.
No, they do not. They are completely in sync. They know exactly what they're going to do before they're going to do it.
Crable, there's a snap, hands the ball off. And he's going, the Lynx are going to be there, gang tackled. That was number 28, P.J. Dean, again on the carry. As a host of Lynx brought him down on the play.
I will say that in the red zone, the Lynx have been very good of not allowing penetration through the trenches. They haven't allowed anybody through that defensive line on those runs that they've had. They've maybe given up a yard or two, but they're bending and not breaking.
No. So it's going to bring up second and goal from the three. Crail fakes the handoff. He's going to look in the end zone, and it's going to be a touchdown for St. Francis. Matt Crable to number 11. Will Chrisman to make the score 20-0. Cougars barring the extra point here with 7:39 to go.
Yeah, Chrisman was unguarded in the end zone. The tight end wide open, a 6'6" tight end, 215 pounds. You think it's for such a big man, he'd be easy to spot.
Yeah.
But he was left wide open, and the Lynx are paying for it again.
Gavin Garner out there for the PAT. There's a snap. Kick is up. Kick is good. So it's going to bring up the score to 21-0. Cougars over the Lynx with 7:39 to go. We're going to take a quick break here. Step aside. More Lynx football when we come back here on Homecoming.
Lindenwood Belleville Television.
LBTV, where you can catch the latest student broadcasts from talk shows to radio shows. Find out what's going on in the area and around campus every Wednesday on LBTV News, channel 12.7 on campus or 989 on Charter Spectrum. Tune in now and see what makes Lindenwood like no other.
Every day in America, over 115 people die due to opioid abuse, including prescription pain relievers, heroin, and synthetic opioids such as fentanyl. It is estimated that 4-6% of Americans who misuse prescription pain relievers transition to heroin. Don't become a statistic. Flush away your prescribed pain pills as soon as you don't need them anymore. These statistics are brought to you by drugabuse.gov.
Welcome back to Lindenwood Stadium as Ricardo Henry fields the kickoff, and he's going to run it out to about the 30-yard line, making the 29. So, Sean, yeah. 7.5 minutes ago in the first quarter, Lynx trailing 20-0. You're the Lynx offense here. What do you need to do on this drive here?
Yeah, get the first down. Get the first down, and they try to extend the play after that and try to build from there. Whether that's through running or over in the air.
I'm thinking maybe like a quick slant.
A quick slant wouldn't be too bad here. You got two guys on the left side, two on the right, a man in the backfield on Chester's side.
A man in motion gets over to the left. He's looking. That's where Chester's looking right now, and he gets it on over to the man in motion on a catch and a first down. Very good for the Lynx there.
It's number 7, Ricardo Henry, on the reception.
Indeed, Aliso. I thought it was a first down. It's just going to be inches. No, it is. They are moving the chains. So that was the key right there, Chris.
I think that's what they need, Sean.
Yep.
Indeed, Aliso.
Chester in the gun once again. Bogans Love to his right side. Man in motion. Going to be a handoff to Bogans Love, who tries to go on the outside, and he is stopped big time by that.
So number 54 for St. Francis on the stop. Bogans Love on the carry. No gain. They get 1 yard gain on. Mitchell Thornberry with the tackle.
He did get a 1 yard gain, so it'll be second and 9.
Second down and 9.
Clock continues to tick here. It's 6:40 to go in this first quarter. Lynx trail 21-0, but they have the ball and a little bit of momentum. Chester in the gun, looking on over to his right. Looking over the middle, that's where he's going to pass to. Good coverage there and a good catch, first down.
That was Henry again.
Ricardo Henry had about two or three cornerbacks, defenders around him, and was able to, Chester was able to thread the needle that time and move the chains. This is the first time the Lynx have moved into Cougar territory offensively.
Yeah, and, you know, with 21-0 St. Francis, if you're the Lynx, you want to keep this offense on the field as much as possible because the defense has been out there quite a bit, and you can't have them out there. They're just, you're worn out.
Exactly. That's a very good point. 46-yard line in the Cougar territory. Chester in the gun. He's looking deep, and that's going to be well out of reach of the intended receiver. Incomplete. The intended receiver for the Lynx, Jordan Flores, just overthrew it by 10 yards. Luckily, no cornerback or safety was there, or else we'll be talking about a the defense being off the field, coming back on the field. Clock stops at 6:01. Chester looking over to the sideline. You'd like to see a little bit of sense of urgency here from the Lynx as well. I mean, you have,
sure would. Yeah.
That, in my opinion, that might throw St. Francis off guard a little bit, but nonetheless.
Chester awaiting the snap. St. Francis showing blitz. Chester dropping back. He's looking downfield. Pass is going to be complete. Good snag by Mitch Peters. It's going to be a gain of about 5 yards on the play.
Yes, Peters looks taking a while to get off the ground, as well as the cornerback that tackled him. I can't get a number on that cornerback, but it's like number
39.
Yeah. 41.
Oh, 41.
41, but they're both on their feet. Peters went to the Lynx sideline under his own power, though, so the athletic trainers of both teams out there to talk to them.
Hey, he seems like he's in good spirits on the sideline, so he seems to
Wilmer Cole for the Cougars is with some athletic trainers, and then he heads to under his own power to the Cougar sideline.
So it's going to bring up 3rd and 5 for the Lynx. Ball on the St. Francis 41-yard line. There's the whistle. Clock will start. Chester awaiting the snap. He's got 2 receivers split to the left and to the right. There's a snap, dropping back pass. He's looking to his left. There's the throw. Pass is going to be intended for Candelaria, but it's going to be just thrown out of bounds. So it's going to bring up 4th and 5. And here's another play here, Sean, another coaching decision. But it looks like they are going to bring out the punt team.
Yeah. The intended receiver for the Lynx may have been held up a little bit by the cornerback, but you know, if the ball wasn't catchable, that's probably where you won't see the flag.
Yep.
But you could also argue the ball wasn't catchable because he was being held. But no.
Both directions.
It could go both directions. Long snap is good for the punt and the hold.
Ripper's punt. It's a high one. And it's going to be reeled in by number 20, Blake Schumacher, inside the 15-yard line.
On the fair catch. We got some scores here from a few of the college football games that are happening. NCAA college football games as well, if anybody listening. Clemson, number 2 ranked Clemson, up on Florida State, 35-0 in the third quarter.
Upset alert here, number 20 Michigan, number 20 Wisconsin, only 11 to Northwestern, who has the ball, and then 21-10 they lead. And that's as far as I'll go, because that's all the teams that are ranked.
For the games that have started.
Yeah, there are other games as well. Wake Forest going up huge. It's 56-34, and they're only in the third quarter.
Well, there's another game here later on today. I think it's Penn State and Iowa, 17th and 18th ranked, so that should be a pretty good game.
Of course, you got Florida and Georgia, number 9 versus number 7 later. A couple other teams ranked against each other. Washington State, number 14 ranked Washington State, number 24 Stanford. That's always a rivalry game between the two teams. And of course, you got my favorite team, Notre Dame, but Navy.
Oh yeah, you and your Notre Dame.
Notre Dame looking to get that college football playoff berth.
So St. Francis dropping back to pass. Pass is going to be incomplete as it was basically thrown in a triple coverage as he was looking for number 1. On the play.
Yeah, Lynx, if they had a little more hustle on that play, possibly could have made an interception. But they did a very good job of the coverage nonetheless. And it's going to be 3rd and 10 here, deep in Cougar territory here. But we know the Cougars, they can quickly come out of this.
So another big play, big possession here for the Lynx defense trying to make a stop here on 3rd down. There's a snap. St. Francis got all the time in the world to throw, but everybody's well coverage. Pass can get thrown at number 7, and that is going to be enough for a 1st down. And I tell you what, Sean, I mean, he had all day to throw.
Clay Cenarius, the backup quarterback, was in there for the Cougars, and like I said, they had all day to throw. Nope, Lynx were being pressured.
So it's going to be 1st and 10 for St. Francis, as they'll officially mark it on their own 26-yard line.
In the gun, in the I formation. It's going to be a handoff. And right up the middle, up the gut, the Lynx doing another good job of not allowing too much up the middle. They do allow about 3 yards on that run, but they're 5 yards, looks like.
Sean, it looks like there's actually a new quarterback into the game for St. Francis. It's number 14, Clay Cenarius.
Not sure what happened to Crable, but he's not in the game now.
So it's 2nd and 5, ball in the 32. So we took under 4 minutes to go here before the end of the first quarter.
Yeah, Kraber on the sideline. He appears to be fine. So
Cenarius driving back to pass. He's looking across the middle. Pass is going to be incomplete. Well covered by number three, Avery Andrews. And Avery Andrews made a couple good plays already here in the first quarter.
He has done a very good job sticking to his man. Dylan Hundley, the intended receiver for the Cougars. With 3:35 to go in this first quarter, Lynx trail 21-0.
So Cenarius has 3 receivers to his right, tailback in the backfield, and a receiver to the left. There's a snap, Snarius dropping back. He's looking across the middle of the field. Pass is going to be complete to number 6, Rocky James, and that is going to be enough to move the chains. So St. Francis will keep the drive going here. It's going to bring up.
That's a very good disguise play. You had all the receivers on one side going deep, and then you had left the middle of the field wide open, right for that lone receiver on the left side cutting into the middle. All they needed was a few yards, and they got it, and they got the first down.
First down.
Didn't advance the ball too far up the field, but just enough to get that first down. It's a very good disguise play there. Drew the linebackers all the way to those other receivers.
Scenarios hands the ball off number 24. That's Martell Williams, freshman out of Indianapolis. He's going to run straight ahead for gain of about 3 or 4 yards on the carry.
Gain of 3 on the play. Second down and 7 yards.
Call it 3 yards officially.
The Cougars slowing the pace down a little bit. They have been on pace, quick no huddle. But now they are in the huddle once again with a backup quarterback in the game, Clay Scenarius.
There's a snap, hands ball off, number 28. And he's going to be short of the first down marker, gain of about 3 yards on the play. That was number 28, P.J. Dean. Who we've called his name quite a bit already here, Sean.
Yeah, he's been handed it off to a lot of times, and a lot of those times he has gone up the middle. The Lynx have only given up just about, in my recollection, they've only given up 5 yards up the middle for a largest carry. That one there is about 2 or 3 yards. They've done a very good job up the middle, but outside, they don't want to get the runner outside. They do a very good job.
So third and 3, Scenarios dropping back. Pass complete across the middle. To number 5,
Dylan Hundley.
So that's going to be enough for a first down. He was brought down by, looked like, was that Avery Andrews again on the stop?
Sure, certainly was. He was brought down hard, too, and here we go. Quick no huddle again. Scenarius handing it off right up the middle. Lynx doing another job of not allowing much up the middle or out just outside.
There's a flag on the play.
The Lynx have done a good job of keeping the run inside the numbers and close to inside the pocket, if not just outside.
Sure have,
well.
Sean. Hey, we actually got multiple flags on the play.
We even got a pink flag out there. Just picked on up. It was a towel.
Pink towel, three flags.
Let's see what kind of foul we got here. Maybe we have multiple fouls on the play.
When you have this many, it's usually offsetting. But we'll see. So there were fouls on both teams, so it's going to be offsetting penalties.
Offsetting penalties. They'll replay it down here. Absolutely. Ball on the Lindenwood 43-yard line. Scenario still in the game. I'm looking at the Cougars sideline, and I see Crable over there. And he's not in any pain. Just hanging out. Hand off up the middle, trying to go outside the numbers, and he will. And I mentioned earlier that the Lynx trying to not get that run outside the numbers, and they do there, and it's a bigger gain for the Cougars.
And that was P.J. Dean on the carry.
Second down, 1 yard to go.
Yeah, their biggest yard run so far, the Cougars going outside the numbers. I think they finally figured out what we see in the booth.
Yeah, I mean, you just mentioned that not even a minute ago there, Sean. And so second and 1. Ball on Lynx 34-yard line as we tick close to 1 minute to go here in the first quarter. There's a snap, Scenarios dropping back to pass. He fakes to his right. He's going to go across the middle. Pass is going to be complete to number 2. That's Jordan Schmeling, and he's going to be brought down.
Right out of bounds.
5-yard line.
Brought out of bounds. He was trying to stay in bounds. If he stays in bounds, he lost his balance a little bit, I should say. But if he stays balanced, he gets in the end zone. But he ran the line and just lost his balance, went out of bounds. He would have definitely had the end zone had he stayed.
So clock running, 45 seconds to go here before the end of the first quarter. First and goal for St. Francis, ball in the 7. There's an end around reverse to number 2. That's Jordan Schmeling. And he's going to get brought down as he tries to reach for the pylon there. And Sean, I can't tell from here if he lost control and that went out of the end zone.
From my angle, it looked like he threw the ball at the pylon. So
yeah, it didn't look like he had control of it.
Yeah, I agree, but the official there who had a better seat than us saw it differently. And
he was right on the play.
Yep. Just lets it go as this clock continues to tick here. Second and goal at the 1. I'm going to call that run up the middle.
Haven't seen any signal. Looks like he is going to be brought down just shy of the goal line. So big stop for the Lynx defense. So it's going to bring up third and goal, which is probably going to be the last play of the first quarter, Sean. With 7 seconds to go, looks like St. Francis is content on letting this go to the second quarter. So teams will switch sides here. At the end of the first quarter, St. Francis University out of Indiana, 9th-ranked team in the nation, leads Lindenwood Belleville 21-0. We're going to take a quick break here. We'll be back for more Lynx football here on Homecoming just after the break.
Here at Lindenwood Belleville, being in the mass communications and broadcasting department gives you the ability to have hands-on experience. The radio station is student-run, where you, the student, are able to produce and air your own show. Besides shows, Lindenwood gives you the ability to do play-by-play for sporting events. All this is basically like an internship itself, as it gives you the hands-on experience as you would receive at a job. This is all possible on KCLC HD3, St. Charles, Belleville.
It all started when you were a child. You started so young, you don't even remember what life was like before your sport. As you grew, so did your love for the game. Being an athlete is a lifestyle. It's your lifestyle, and you wouldn't change it for the world. You wouldn't change waking up at 5 a.m. for practice after staying up all night doing homework. You wouldn't change anyone on your team because they're your family, and as much as they get on your nerves, you wouldn't be where you are without them. You wouldn't change moving 12 hours away from home and leaving your entire life behind. You wouldn't change putting countless hours in the weight room to be your very best no matter how much it hurts. You take that extra step because you're an athlete, and athletes don't quit, and neither does your love for the game. Evaluate your game by spending time at the Lindenwood Belleville Fitness Center. Open 7 days a week, weekdays until 10:30 p.m., and weekends until 5 p.m. It's a great day to be at Lynx.
And so the handoff up the middle, touchdown for the Cougars, flag on the play. Right afterwards, it's going to be washed out by the.
Did you see maybe a holding there?
Yeah, I saw a holding on the Cougars. Sean Ditch alongside Chris Smith. Sorry about that. 5 seconds in, we have another delay in this quarter.
So you're right, Sean. It's going to be a hold there on St. Francis, so it's going to bring up third and goal from the 11?
Yeah, it's a fortunate break there for the Lynx.
So really all you're hoping for here for the Lynx is to hold them here and, you know, just set up a field goal.
Got some first quarter stats here for you. P.J. Dean, the lead runner. His longest run has been 30 yards and has averaged 7.6 yards a carry. But I doubt he'll get the ball here as it's wide receivers trips to the left side of Cenarius and a timeout called by the Cougars.
Timeout called by the Cougars. Timeout,
their first of the half. It's going to be their first timeout of the half. So we'll keep it right here. We'll keep it locked here.
And, you know, for the Lynx offense, you had Chester, 6 of 10, first quarter, 53 yards. Did have an interception. And Ricardo Henry, the leading receiver for the Lynx, 2 catches for 25 yards. Only 3 penalties in the first quarter.
2 of them on the Lynx.
And one of the stats you have to look at here, Sean, in the first quarter was the third down conversions. St. Francis was 3 of 4 while the Lynx were 0 for 2.
Yeah, that could be a difference maker. You had the better teams usually do capitalize on their chances. And the Cougars have done that 3 out of 4 times so far. The Lynx have not. That just means we're due.
I think we are due, Sean.
We are due. But we need the ball first to do that.
Yeah, we do.
First, third and goal. The 11-yard line. Trips offset to Cenarius' right side. He is in the gun. Looking to his left. He's going to throw it there. Pass is going to be caught. It's going to be a one-on-one battle. That is won by the Lynx cornerback. Very good job. Tackled around the 5-yard line number.
That was big, big-time tackle by Daquan Stewart there, Sean, as it was just him between the receiver and the end zone, and he was with him step for step and was able to bring him down.
So that field goal unit coming on for the Cougars now. Gavin Gardner on for the field goal attempt, about a 28-yard field goal. A 24-yard field goal, I should say, and it's chip shot, and it's up and it's good. And now the Cougars lead up 24-0 on our Lynx of Lynnwood University. Take a short break, 14-11 to go, second quarter. We'll be right back. This is Lynnwood Lynx football.
Lindenwood Belleville Television.
LBTV, where you can catch the latest student broadcasts from talk shows to radio shows. Find out what's going on in the area and around campus every Wednesday on LBTV News. Channel 12.7 on campus or 989 on Charter Spectrum. Tune in now and see what makes Lindenwood like no other.
Welcome back to Lindenwood Stadium here. Homecoming day for Lindenwood. St. Francis leads the Lynx 24-0. St. Francis kicking off after the Lynx held St. Francis to a field goal. Back deep to receive for the Lynx. Number 4, Jalen Bogans Love. And number 7, Ricardo Henry. Bogans Love is going to take that and take a knee in the end zone, so it's going to be a touchback. And the Lynx offense take over at the 25-yard line here, Sean. And like you said earlier,
we're due to
get the ball back.
We're due.
So the Lynx offense takes over on the 25-yard line as we are in the second quarter now. Each team with 2 timeouts remaining in the half. Chester's got 2 receivers to the right, to his right, that's Henry and Peters, and 2 receivers to his left with Owens in the backfield. There's a snap, hands it off to Owens. He's going to run straight ahead, and not much doing there, Sean, as he's maybe going to pick up a yard.
He ran right into the hole that, right into the wall of Lynx defenders in front of him, and that just good breakdown there by the Cougars in the trenches. So
it should be 2nd and 9 here for the Lynx. Looks like they're going to give him 2 yards on the play, so 2nd and 8, ball on the 27. Chester awaiting the snap. There's a snap. He's dropping back to pass. He's looking to his left. Throws it downfield. Pass is going to be over the head and thrown out of bounds. His intended receiver is number 2, Jordan Flores. So it's going to bring up a long 3rd down here for the Lynx.
Yeah, it had the right idea, did Chester. Just overthrew the ball highly enough and out of the reach of the intended receiver, Jordan Flores.
So it's going to be a big play here for the Lynx offense here, Sean, and I would expect St. Francis to show blitz.
I agree, and like I said, Lynx are due for a 3rd down conversion here.
Chester dropping back to pass. He's looking across the middle. Pass is going to be complete to number 7, Ricardo Henry, but that is not going to be enough for a 1st down. It's going to be a gain of 3. So it's going to bring up 4th and 5 on their own 30-yard line.
So it's a 3 and out for the Lynx there. Maybe they're due on the next go-around.
So the Lynx special team unit comes onto the field along with St. Francis. Riley Ripper out there do the punting duties. Ripper awaiting the snap. There's a snap. Punt is up. Punt is blocked by St. Francis, and they are going to take that back for a touchdown. So it's going to be 30-0 barring the extra point here for St. Francis.
You can hear the Francis faithful coming alive there as Mannion was the one that got the scoop and score on the blocked punt. And so it is 30-0, like Chris said.
As we are just under 13 minutes to go here until halftime, 30-0, St. Francis barring the extra point here. Number 87 out for the PAT for St. Francis. That's Gavin Gardner. Gardner awaiting the snap. There's a snap. Kick is up. Kick is good. So it's going to be 31-0 Cougars with 12:56 to go here in the second quarter. We're going to step aside for a quick commercial break here. When we get back, more Lynx football here on Homecoming.
Here at Lindenwood Belleville, being in the Mass Communications and Broadcasting Department gives you the ability to have hands-on experience. The radio station is student-run, where you, the student, are able to produce and air your own show. Besides shows, Lindenwood gives you the ability to do play-by-play for sporting events. All this is basically like an internship itself, as it gives you the hands-on experience as you would receive at a job. This is all possible on KCLC HD3, St. Charles, Belleville.
Sounds good.
And welcome back to Lindenwood Stadium here. Lindenwood Belleville hosting ninth-ranked St. Francis University of Indiana. Cougars lead the Lynx 31-0 here on homecoming. St. Francis ready to kick off. There's the kick. It's going to be fielded by number one. That's Denzel Leach. He's out across the 20-yard line. He's going to step out of a tackler, and he's going to run straight forward and get brought down by a host of St. Francis tacklers. He's going to be just short of the 25-yard line. Make it the 24-yard line where the Lynx offense will take over after the blocked punt by St. Francis.
Well, let's see what the Lynx can do here. As they are congregating over there by the Lynx sideline. 12:44 to go in this second quarter.
So it's 31-0, Sean. What do you think the message is from the coaching staff on the Lynx sideline right now going into this offensive possession?
Just get a first down. Keep it simple. Get the first down and build from there.
Chester's got three receivers to the left, one receiver to the right. And we're going to – I thought we were going to have a free play there, but the St. Francis defender did touch one of the offensive players. It's going to be an offside. So it's going to
– why couldn't that be a 50-yard penalty?
I don't know. I have yet to see one of those penalties. So it's going to bring up first and five for the Lynx after the offside penalty on St. Francis. Moves the ball up to the Lynx own 29-yard line. Same formation set up here. The Lynx have three receivers to the left. Bogans Love in the backfield. There's a handoff to Bogans Love. He's going to hop out of a tackler. He's got some running room. He's going to get brought down after a big gain. He's out across the 45-yard line. We'll make it the 46. So a good run there by Bogans Love there, Sean.
Yeah, Bogans Love finally found that hole, got the penetration, went through very well. Biggest offensive play so far here for the Lynx in this game. Brings them just shy of midfield.
So first and 10 for the Lynx. Ball on their own 46-yard line. Formation is flipped. Chester's got three receivers to his right. One split out to the left. Hands it off to Bogans Love again. He's going to run straight forward. Hops out of a tackler. And he's going to have positive yardage.
Yep.
But he easily could have brought down for a loss there, Sean. But
he could have. He avoided one tackle, bounced off one tackler. Gets a gain of the maximum 2 yards, if anything, generously. And they do give him 2 yards. How about that? We need every yard we can get.
Do. So, going to bring up second and eight. as the Lynx are creeping closer to St. Francis territory. Chester relaying the play. Two receivers split to the left, two to his right. Bogans Love is still in the backfield for him to his left. Floor is in motion, and we got a penalty on the play, flag. It looks like we're going to have a delay of game on the Lynx, so it's going to back them up 5 yards. So it's going to bring up second and 13. Ball on their own 43-yard line.
Let's see what we can do. I'm expecting a big play downfield here.
I think you're right, Sean. Floor is in motion. Chester dropping back. He's looking deep down the field. He's got Candelaria, and he's... Oh!
Throw the flag.
Yeah.
There you go.
Candelaria was close to reeling in a one-handed snag there, but, you know, as the refs did throw two flags on the play, there was clearly defensive pass interference there on the play as he was being held.
And it was a catchable ball, and he tried to reach up with one hand and make the grab. If this was the NFL, this would be a spot foul. I wish it was, but it's college football, so it won't be a spot foul. It'll be 15 yards down the field, first down.
So it looks like they're actually going to call a holding on the play, which, I mean, Sean,
I'm going to say flat out and say that is a terrible call. That should have been a pass interference.
He was all over him.
He was all over him. I mean, deep down the field, that is a pass interference call 99 times out of 100. Clearly, this is that one time out of 100.
So, but either way, it's going to bring up a first down for the Lynx. Even though the chain gang still says second down. But it's an automatic first down for the Lynx. There we go. Chain gang's got it. So clock is stopped at 11:08 right now to go till halftime. First and 10. Ball in the St. Francis 47-yard line.
Let's do it again. Do the same exact play.
Chester looking to deep downfield, and he's not going to have anywhere to go as he's going to get brought down for a sack. So it's going to be a loss of yards on the play. I couldn't tell which St. Francis player brought him down, Sean, but there was a host of them back there.
Yeah, there were a good number of them. It looked like Chester tried to run out of the pocket, ended up running into possibly one of his own defenders as well. But with 10:40 to go here in the second quarter, the Lynx are on their second down. It's going to be second and loss. It's second and 12, I assume.
It might be a little bit more than that.
Oh, yeah.
Second 16. And 16.
Oh, that is a... questionable spot, but oh well.
Chester dropping back to pass. He's looking downfield, and pass is complete to Bogans Love as he's going to get about back to the original line of scrimmage. So he's going to pick up about six and yet
tackled right on the U of the LU logo here at midfield.
And right there, Sean, I mean, Chester was looking downfield, but he really didn't have any other options than to check it down to Bogans Love because he was getting backed up by a St. Francis defender that was right in his face.
He rolled down a third and 11 at the 46. Why did they put it at the 46? It's a 48.
So third down for the Lynx, third and long. Chester, three receivers split to his right, one to his left. The lone receiver to the left is Flores. Bogans Love in the backfield. Chester dropping back. He's looking deep downfield. It's at Candelaria. And it was just underthrown, and pass going to be incomplete. So, I mean, Sean, that was about identical play they just ran earlier to get that holding call. So it is going to bring up fourth and 11 for the Lynx, and the punt team is coming on for the Lynx, so that is Riley Ripper out there.
Personally, I would go for it in this situation, but this is why I'm not a football coach.
So Ripper out to punt for the Lynx, back deep to receive for St. Francis is number 7, Dan Rixey. There's a snap.
Flag off the snap.
Punt is up.
Maybe an offside, so maybe the Lynx will get a repunt here.
Well, coverage by the Lynx, as he didn't call for a fair catch, and he was tackled by number one, Denzel Leach, instantly.
We got a flag as soon as the snap happened. Let's see what happens.
It looks like this is going to be on St. Francis, Gordon, if I'm seeing the officials pointing correctly. So if this does go against St. Francis, Sean, this brings up a big decision for the Lynx coaching staff, because this would make it probably 4th and 6 instead of 4th and 11.
So that washes out the punt that just happened.
So it looks like they're just going to take
so
that 5 yards.
About football is just, or at least I knew about the rules, it's just completely gone to the wayside in this game with the officiating.
So they're going to take that offsides on the punt and add that to the end of the kick, so that'll back them up the Cougars an extra 5 yards as they are now inside their 5-yard line. So Lynx defense back out onto the field, and we got some more whistles. Looks like they're going to change out the football.
How about a scoop and score here for the Lynx?
That'd be nice. And score, pick six. I'll take either.
I'll take a sack. I'll take a safety at this point.
I mean, Sean, it looks like number three, Matt Crable, is back into the game at quarterback.
Yes, he is. Just wanted, a snack break or something.
There's a snap. Crable rolling out to his left. Passes complete to number six. And he's going to be out across close to the 20-yard line. So, I mean, he's going to have enough for a first down. That was Rocky James on the reception. And that moves the chains. So it's going to bring up 1st and 10 for the Cougars. They're going to mark that officially on their own 18-yard line.
I looked over at the coverage toward that receiver. There was hardly anybody there for the Lynx. It was an easy pass and an easy play.
Crable looking deep downfield. He's going to heave it up. And pass is complete to number six, Rocky James. He steps out of a tackler and pass.
Fumble
on the play. And
recovered.
And recovered by the Cougars, it looks like.
They said that he was down anyway.
He was already down. So either way, a big completion for the Cougars. Crable to Rocky James as that moves the Cougars inside the Lynx territory as they are now inside the 30-yard line. I mean, Sean, it was a really well-thrown ball.
Coverage by the Lynx as well. Just didn't have a step on the runner. This is where you got to tip your hat off to a better play.
Yeah. I mean, like you said, it was well covered by the Lynx defense.
It was.
So they're going to officially mark it at the 25 after they said he was down before he fumbled. There's a snap. Hand off to number 24.
Flag on the play.
Martell
Williams. A little after the tackle. It was a spot around the original line of scrimmage, the foul here. So I'm going to guess it's a hold on the I don't want to speculate.
So it is going to be a hold on the Cougars. So it's going to bring up be a 10-yard penalty there on the Cougars. So it's going to back them up to their own, or to the Lynx 35-yard line. So first and 20. For the Cougars. Crable, two receivers to the right, one on the left. He's rolling out to his right. He's going to throw it back cross field, and it is going to be incomplete as he was looking for number 24, Martell Williams. It's tailback that was in the game on that play. But he was well covered by, I think that was number 67 for the Lynx, Sean.
Yeah.
Nathan.
My bad, I should be looking at the rosters. Nathan Rotten.
So clock is stopped at 8:12, 2nd and 20. There's a snap. Crable's gonna tuck it and run it, and he's got some running room. And he's going to run straight forward, and he's going to break across the outside, and he's going to dive for the pylon. And the refs are going to signal it is a Cougar touchdown as he went untouched right up the middle and then broke off to his left, hopped out of a tackler, and then it was just daylight from there. And it's going to bring up the score to 37-0 Cougars.
Yeah, Crable showed some athleticism right
sure
there. He faked the pitch and had me faked in the booth here and ran right up the middle of the gut. Then we ran outside the numbers, dove for the pylon, like you said, and it was just a good play of athleticism there from Matt Crable. Looks like everything's fine with him.
Gardner out for the PAT for Cougars. There's a snap. Kick is up. Kick is good. So we got a score of 38 for the Cougars, the Lynx 0. Got exactly 8 minutes to go here in the second quarter. We're going to step aside for a quick commercial break here, and when we get back, more football between the Cougars and Lynx here on Homecoming Day at Lindenwood Stadium.
One of the new and exciting additions to the Lindenwood Belleville campus is the Major General William L. Enyard Veterans Success Center. There are over 100 VA students on the Belleville campus, and the Enyard Veterans Success Center provides a lounge and study space to meet and adjust to college life. It also has information about GI Bills, benefits, and available tuition assistance. It's a mini USO. For more information, call 618-239-6208 or visit belleville.lindenwood.edu.
And welcome back to Lindenwood Stadium as the Cougars are set to kick off to the Lynx after a rushing touchdown by Crable. There's the kick. It's going to be Bogans Love's going to let go over his head, and it's going to end up being a touchback. So the Lynx will take over on their own 25-yard line to start the drive here with exactly 8 minutes to go until halftime.
Well, if you're watching NCAA college football, the Florida State finally did score.
Did they?
45-3.
Oh, wow, I wonder what the spread was in that game.
25-yard line, first down.
Who knows? Clemson was 18-point favorites. I don't think Florida State's going to have to worry about covering that one.
Let's see if we can get some points on the board here with our drive.
I'm feeling confident on this drive, Sean. Chester's pass complete to Ricardo Henry. He's got some running room. He's going to have enough for a first down.
Man, if he didn't have that out of bounds.
Oh, he was gone.
He was gone. We would have scored.
So it's going to be a gain of 12, Chester to Henry on the completion. First and 10 ball on the 37 for the Lynx. Clock running. Chester's got two receivers to his right, one to the left. Jaquay Owens in the backfield. Chester, quick pass to Henry, and he's going to thought he hopped out of one tackler, but not much.
Couldn't get two.
Yeah. Looks like he's going to have a short gain of about three on the play. Looks like they're going to give him 4 yards. He's going to bring up second and 6. Ball on their own 41-yard line. Looks like Owens into the game, still for the Lynx in the backfield. Chester awaiting the snap. There's the snap, hands it off to Owens. He's going to run straight ahead, and he's going to keep his legs moving as he's going to churn forward for positive yardage, as it looks like they're going to give him about 2 or 3 on the play. Either way, it's going to bring up third down. They're going to call it gain of 2 on Owens' rush attempt. So 3rd and 4, ball on their own 43-yard line. Tell you what, Sean, one of the plays we haven't seen yet is a quick slant across the middle.
Yeah.
There's a snap. Chester dropping back to pass. Pass is complete to Owens. He's going to try to hop out of a tackler, but he was going to get dragged down by number 31 for St. Francis, so it's going to bring up 4th down and 2 for the Lynx, and it looks like they are going to bring the punt unit onto the field. So Riley Ripper out. We with number 7 deep to receive for the Cougars, Dan Rixey. Ripper awaiting the snap. There's a snap. Punt is up.
No fair catch.
No
ball.
Fair catch by Rixey. He's got some running room. He's out across the 40. He's out to midfield, hops over a tackler. He's past the 40. He's at the 30. He's at the 20.
He's gone.
The 10. That's going to be a touchdown for St. Francis. As there are no, didn't look like there are any flags on the play. So punt return for Dan Rixey on the play. So it's going to bring the score to 44-0. St. Francis with 5:22 to go until halftime. St. Francis, PAT unit onto the field. That's number 87, Gavin Garner out there. There's a snap, kick is up, kick is good.
And all of his PATs have gone out into the parking lot behind the stands. I just hope my car ain't dented.
I was going to say, I hope it didn't hit my car.
It didn't hit my car either. I got that VIP parking today.
As did I, Sean.
All right.
It looks like we got a
fight here.
Scuffle going on as emotions are being shown, and there is a flag on the play as refs are having to get in the middle of both teams here, right out in front of our press box here. And we got another flag on the play. So we were going to go to a commercial break, but we'll stay right here to see what the flags are.
Turn down the crowd, Mike.
We're getting a pretty good.
Getting some pretty good words here on the air.
And we got the St. Francis sideline right in front of us.
Yeah, we do. We apologize for any of the listeners listening.
I have a feeling it might take the refs a little bit to sort this one out.
Yeah.
The refs continuing to sort this one out. Five officials in the middle of the field discussing what just happened. Well, we do have a break in the action. Clemson to tack on some more points, Sean. At the end of the third quarter, Clemson leads Florida State 52-3.
Like hockey, the Devils beat the Panthers today 3-2.
Yeah, they had an afternoon game.
See, I believe U of I plays Maryland today.
Well, that should be a barn burner.
Yep, Illinois plays at Maryland at 2:30, so that game getting ready to kick off here. Just in about 20 minutes. We'll go into the SEC here, and
Wake Forest is looking to win against Louisville at 56-35. There was no more scoring from when we stated earlier in the third quarter. It was the same score that it is presently.
You got 12th-ranked Kentucky at Mizzou. Mizzou 7.5-point favorites on against 12th-ranked Kentucky there. That game kicks off in just under an hour at 3 o'clock. Refs still discussing here what they're going to do. I don't know if maybe
I can bet you somebody's getting tossed.
I was going to say, I don't want to speculate and say there's going to be an ejection here or something.
You don't want to speculate, but you know, when you're down 45-0, I think you can speculate. So in the second quarter.
Yeah, and you know, obviously emotions are going to be high here and you know, in this situation, but
especially for the Lynx. I mean, you're on home field, it is homecoming, and you're down 45-0 in the second half, in the second quarter, speaks for itself.
Looks like the refs have figured out the situation here.
And we're going to have something. We're going to have some kind of presentation from the official, from the referee.
Might have multiple penalties on the play here. So it looks like all the penalties are going to go against the Lynx here. All unsportsmanlike conduct penalties. So
five unsportsmanlike conduct penalties all on the Lynx.
So this is going to get marked off on the kickoff. So, Sean, I'm not entirely sure where they're going to be kicking off from. I've not seen three penalties.
I can bet you that they're kicking off at some place on the field. That's all I know. That's all I know right now. I mean,
That's a very good observation.
That's a
Sean.
Very good observation. I'm going to stick with that.
Someone find a bell to ring. That's a hot take.
Yeah. It is going to be a Cougar kickoff. They might be kicking off at the Lynx 45-yard line. Who knows? I mean,
because an unsportsmanlike conduct, that's 15 yards, so.
Oh, my.
I don't know if that means they're. If that's
maybe
15,
it'll take,
15
it'll,
and yeah. 15? I don't.
It might take on after the kickoff. It might go half the distance of the goal.
I've not seen anything like that before, Sean.
Neither have I. This is unique. So while they're getting it figured out, we're going to take a short break here with 5:22 to go. The Lynx trail 45-0. In the second quarter, 5:22 to go. This is Lindenwood Lynx football.
Here at Lindenwood Belleville, being in the Mass Communications and Broadcasting Department gives you the ability to have hands-on experience. The radio station is student-run, where you, the student, are able to produce and air your own show. Besides shows, Lindenwood gives you the ability to do play-by-play for sporting events. All this is basically like an internship itself, as it gives you the hands-on experience as you would receive at a job. This is all possible on KCLC HD3, St. Charles, Belleville.
The Lindenwood Library is a place to go for all the answers, whether you need to find a good book to pass the time or a credible source from our databases. The library is the place to go. We provide countless computers, printers, scanners, and space to carry out any homework or studying you need to get done. You can even come for some peace and quiet if that's what you're looking for. Our staff is dedicated to helping you in any way they can, and our hours are suited to fit everyone's needs. Open Monday through Thursday.
And welcome back to Lindenwood Stadium, where the Cougars are kicking off from the Lindenwood 20-yard line. I've never seen this before.
Sean, I've yet to see this happen.
Holy cow. It's going to be a little boost kick. Yep, exactly. Ball must travel 10 yards, and it's going to be a Cougar football as they gather it up as the Lynx touch it.
So after the punt return for the touchdown, there were five penalties on Lindenwood, all unsportsmanlike conduct, and that marked off basically 45 yards, I believe, because there were three penalties getting marked off, and that had the Cougars kick off from the Lynx 20-yard line. They did a little squib kick, which ended up being fumbled by the Lynx and recovered by the Cougars. So with 5:21 to go here in the second quarter, Crable and company for the Cougars are back out onto the field. Lynx defense hoping to make a stand here. And there's a snap. Crable pass complete to number 7. And he's going to run outside of a tackler, hop across one, and get brought down just shy of the pylon. That was number 7, Dan Rixey, on the reception. Ball's going to be spotted at the 2-yard line.
run to the 3rd yard. They're going to go from the 3 yard line.
Boy, what a game.
So, second down for the Cougars. Crable trying a QB sneak as he's going to get stuffed, and then he's going to back up and
roll out
to
the outside.
Right. Yeah, as you said, Sean.
My bad.
Nowhere to go there for him. Bring up 3rd down. So, big play there for the Lynx defense, Sean.
Indeedly so.
Cougars offense making substitutions here. Clock continuing to tick. Creeping up on 4 minutes to go here until halftime. 3rd and 1. The Cougars, there's a snap. The high snap, ooh, he bobbles it. And he's going to get brought down for, looks like, a loss on the play. So the Lynx are going to be there to stop him on 4th down. So 4th and 2. And it looks like the Cougars are going to bring out the field goal unit. So that's Gavin Gardner coming out for the Cougars to attempt the field goal. So the Lynx defense did what they needed, Sean. Held them to a field goal attempt here. There's the snap. Kick is up. Kick is good as it flies out the back of the bleachers in the end zone. So it's going to be 48-0 Cougars. 3:26 to go here until halftime. We're going to step aside for a commercial break here. More Lynx football when we return.
Every day in America, over 115 people die due to opioid abuse, including prescription pain relievers, heroin, and synthetic opioids such as fentanyl. It is estimated that 4-6% of Americans who misuse prescription pain relievers transition to heroin. Don't become a statistic. Flush away your prescribed pain pills as soon as you don't need them anymore. These statistics are brought to you by drugabuse.gov.
This time from their own yard line as the ball bounces out of bounds. It'll be a touchback. And Chester back on the field for the Lynx. It's going to be a play action handoff and batted out of on the way there. And incomplete pass. Pass was intended for Peters of the Lynx, but it was batted down by the defensive lineman. .322 to go in this first half. And thrown on over to the left side of Chester. It is caught and ran all the way to the first down.
Tell you what, Sean.
Parker.
The pass was completed to Ricardo Henry, and Ricardo Henry's had a very nice game today. Very nice game.
He certainly has.
He seems to be Chester's go-to this afternoon, and Chester's got 3 receivers to the right, 1 to the left. hands the ball off to Bogan's Love. He's going to go straight ahead, and there's not going to be anything doing there as it's going to be a couple Cougars there on the stop. Going to bring up second down. Loss of two on the play. Second and 12. As we creep closer to halftime here, Sean, just over 2.5 minutes to go. Chester awaiting the snap. There's a snap. Hands it off to Bogan's Love. He's going to go straight ahead. Lowers his shoulder. He's going to have enough for a first down. As he's up close to the 45-yard line, make it the 46. So looks like they're going to call it a gain of 14 yards on the carry by Bogan's Love.
Yeah, Bogan's Love has had a nice day on carries, running up the middle, outside the numbers, inside the numbers, inside the pockets, doing a very good job in finding the holes in the penetration in the defensive line. And he's done very good for the Lynx today.
Bogan's Love on the handoff again. He's just going to steamroll over a guy, and he's going to get brought down right at midfield. So gain of 4 on the play, bring up 2nd and 6. Got a minute 40 until halftime. Ball is on midfield for the Lynx. The Lynx do have 2 timeouts if they need to turn one before halftime. So 2nd down. Chester's got 3 receivers split to the right. That's Mitch Peters, Ricardo Henry, and Flores. 1 receiver to the left. It's Candelaria. Chester dropping back. He's looking downfield for Candelaria. He's got Candelaria. The pass is going to be complete to Candelaria as he's going to be brought down inside the red zone, even inside the 10. Call it the 5-yard line. Big pass completion from Chester to Candelaria. Big play there, Sean. Maybe that's what the Lynx need.
To be perfectly honest, that's the first time I've heard the band play all afternoon.
You're not wrong.
Since during this game, anyway. We got a minute to go here. Can the Lynx get on the board?
Hey, maybe this is what the Lynx need going into halftime. Bring some momentum going into halftime. Come back out. Start the second half with, putting some points on the board. It's a handoff to Bogan's Love. He's going to break out of the tackle. He's going to be in for a Lynx touchdown. Touchdown, Bogan's Love, as he was carrying tacklers into the end zone as he dove into the left pylon. So it's going to Lynx chipping into the deficit here as it's 48.
We're not dead yet.
48-6, barring the extra point, with 42 seconds to go till halftime. Riley Ripper out to perform the PAT duties this afternoon.
Chester's going to be the holder for him.
Ripper awaiting snap. Chester's got snap. High snap. He gets it down. Ripper's PAT is up and good. Your score, 48-7. Cougars over the Lynx. We've only got 42 seconds till halftime, so we'll just keep it right here. So, Sean, maybe that's what they need going into the start the second half.
Yeah, we'll get the ball to start the second half as well. The Lynx will. 48-7, they trail. And this is something that they can build upon.
I mean, scoring right before halftime, getting that momentum, that can do a lot for a lot of people's confidence. Big confidence.
How about a boost kick here? We recover the kickoff and get another score before half is over.
How about that? I'm not opposed to it.
I'm not opposed to it either. Let's just shock the world here with that.
Ripper getting ready to kick off to the Cougars. Back deep to receive for the Cougars. Number 22, Stan Jackson. Ripper approaching the football. There's the kick. Oh. It's going to be a short kick. It's going to be fielded at the 25-yard line. And he's going to get brought down almost instantly by number 32 on Lindenwood, Nate Collins, on the tackle. So Cougars will take over with 37 seconds to go until halftime. Ball will be placed on the, I believe, the 26-yard line. Make it to 27. Cougars have two timeouts left. I'd be shocked if they use either of them before halftime. There's a snap, handoff, straight ahead. Positive yardage there, brought down by number 67 for the Lynx, Nathan Rotten, as the clock will continue to run, as the Cougars do not have to run another play before halftime if they do not want to. Well, looks like they might try to set up one final play here. 9 seconds to go until halftime, and it looks like they're going to be content on running out the clock here. So that's going to take us to halftime here on homecoming day at Lindenwood Belleville. So we're going to step aside, play some music for you during halftime. We'll be back in about 20 minutes. St. Francis University Cougars, ranked 9th in the nation, lead Lindenwood Belleville 48-7. We'll be back in about 20 minutes for the second half at Lindenwood Stadium.
Thank you. Hello and welcome to the 2018 Homecoming Coronation. I'm Austin Bearden, Linwood Belleville Student Government President. I'm very excited to introduce our Homecoming Court Attendant and Homecoming Queen and King. I would like to first welcome Dr. Susie Jones, Linwood Belleville's Dean of Students, and Alyssa Wyman, last year's Homecoming Queen and Linwood Belleville alumni, both of whom will crown this year's Homecoming Queen and King. Dr. Susie Jones, Dean of Students, is best known around campus as Dr. Sparker. She started at Linwood Belleville in 2015. She enjoys the day-to-day interactions with students and participated in a growing campus culture. She lives in Redbud, Illinois with her two sons and her golden doodle. Alyssa Wyman, the 2017 Homecoming Queen, is a Linwood Belleville alumni who graduated in spring 2018. She majored in elementary education and currently teaches at Shiloh Elementary. Now, for the freshman homecoming court attendants, I would like to introduce Brianna Barrows and Alex Gonzalez. Brianna is from Frisco, Texas. She is on the cheerleading team at Linwood Belleville and is majoring in business. Alexander is from Riviera, Texas. He is on the cheerleading team at Linwood Belleville and is majoring in history and theater. For the sophomore homecoming court attendants, I would like to introduce Clara Golden and Tanasha McKenna. Clara is from Houston, Texas. She is on the women's basketball team at Linwood Belleville, considers eating to be her main hobby, and is majoring in exercise science. Tanasha is from Harare, Zimbabwe. She is on the rugby team at Linwood Belleville and is majoring in interactive media and web design. For the junior homecoming court attendants, I'd like to introduce Brittany Holmes and Devontae White. Brittany is from Pontiac, Illinois. She is on the cheerleading team at Linwood Belleville, tanks in her free time, and is majoring in mass communications and advertising with a minor in criminal justice. Devontae is from Jacksonville, Illinois. He is on the cheerleading team and dance team at Linwood Belleville, is the captain of the hip-hop team, and is double majoring in English and history. And now, for the senior team candidates, I would like to introduce Madison Beck, Erica Ferrizzi, Maisie Kincaid, and Mayel Miller. Madison is from Webster Groves, Missouri. She is on the soccer team at Linwood Belleville and is majoring in exercise science and plans to be a health enthusiast and adventurous after she graduates. Unfortunately, Maddie will not be here today because she is with the soccer team. Erica is from Allentown, Pennsylvania. She is on the cheerleading team at Linwood Belleville and is majoring in exercise science and plans to be a strength and conditioning coach after she graduates. Maisie is from Bristol, England. She is on the soccer team at Linwood Belleville and is majoring in elementary education and wants to coach soccer and pursue a career in counseling after she graduates. Mayel is from Birmingham, Alabama. She is on the basketball team at Linwood Belleville and is majoring in criminal justice with a minor in sociology and plans to work as juveniles within the correctional system after she graduates. And finally, for the senior team candidates, I would like to introduce Darius Ford, Zach Knorr, Iamare Oyemolan, and Dalton Turner. Darius is from Chicago, Illinois. He is on the baseball team at Linwood Belleville and enjoys collecting sports memorabilia. He is majoring in exercise science and plans to be a physical therapist or personal trainer after he graduates. Zachariah is from Detroit, Michigan. He is on the basketball team at Linwood Belleville, is the president of Phi Beta Sigma, is double majoring in criminal justice and sociology, and plans to get a master's degree in information technology after he graduates to pursue a career in cybersecurity. Iamare, or Alpha, as many of you know, is from Antioch, California. He is on the rugby team at Linwood Belleville and is a blogger and musician. He is majoring in business administration with an emphasis in human resource management and plans to continue to play rugby in a professional league after he graduates, in addition to pursuing a career as a coach or administrative executive. Dalton is from Rowell, Missouri. He is on the baseball team at Linwood Belleville and is majoring in exercise science and plans to pursue a career in physical therapy after he graduates. Please give it up for your queen and king candidates. Now for the moment everyone has been waiting for, the announcement of this year's homecoming queen and king. This year's homecoming queen and king are Mayel Miller and Zachariah Knorr. Please give the 2018 queen and king a round of applause. Thank you all for coming out to our 2018 homecoming coronation. Thank you. And can I get one last round of applause for our queen and king? On behalf of Cheatham Government, I would like to let you guys know there is a raffle down the west end entrance. We had many businesses in the area that contributed to our raffles, which will help us go to New York for the Student Government Association Conference. We would like to thank our sponsors, The Edge, Ambassador Travel, Hair on Main, Abe's Popcorn, Rising Stars, Lincoln Theater, Toothcake and Candy Supplies, Local Lucy's, and Kurt Smith. Thank you for your contributions. The winner of those raffles will be announced at the end of the third quarter, so please look at your tickets on the west end of the stadium. Thank you.
Sean, there's a breeze. Start of the third quarter here. There's the kick from the Cougars. Back deep to receivers Candelaria and Henner. They're both going to let that sail out of the end zone for a touchback. So the Lynx will take over on their 25-yard line. But before the end of the first half, Sean, the Lynx got on the board. And hopefully that was some momentum carrying over into the second half here. And that's a sign of good things to come here.
Yeah, it should be. You'd hope so. And Lynx do trail 48-7, but you know, anything is possible. In the third quarter here, they got 15 minutes on the board. Sean Ditch alongside Chris Smith here in the broadcast booth. The Lynx are going back with Chester here.
Chester's got receiver to the left, fakes the handoff to Owens, looking out to his left, passes complete to Flores. Completion, Chester to Flores. Gain of 4 on the play.
Yeah, Flores with another great catch. He's been an offensive boost for the Lynx today. A bright spot for them as he was wrapped up by the cornerback of the Cougars.
Ricardo Henry in the first half, 6 catches for 54 yards, so he was Chester's go-to. Steve Candelari also 2 receptions for 53 yards. Bogans Love at 43 rushing yards in the first half, along with a touchdown. Chester awaiting the snap, and we got some movement here. Flags on the play. I'll be honest, Sean, I couldn't tell if it was a false start or an offside. It
looked like a little bit of both. Let's just let him play and keep going. That's my opinion.
So it is going to be a false start on the Lynx. So 2nd and 7 will back him up to 2nd and 12. As we are just under 30 seconds into the second half.
Oh, that's a bummer. Let's see if the Lynx can regroup here with 2nd and 12, get something going, get some momentum going.
There's the snap, fakes the handoff to Owens. He's going to look downfield. Chester's going to scramble out and gets back to the original line of scrimmage, so he's going to pick up probably 2 yards on the play.
See, in the NFL right there, that isn't roughing the passer. Why isn't that here in college football?
You're talking about because he slid down and then got hit?
Yeah.
I don't know if maybe the officials thought that the defender was already in his motion for tackling him. Like, but I don't know. I see where you're coming from, though, Sean. And that was a play where they possibly could have thrown a flag. Could have gone either way. They chose to hold on to the flag. So 3rd and 10 for the Lynx. Chester's got three receivers to the right, one to the left. He's dropping back to pass. He's looking downfield. He's scrambling out. He's got St. Francis defenders all over him, and he's going to get brought down for a sack. So loss of yards on the play for the Lynx. So it's going to bring up 4th and long.
Justin Groves, the freshman, and on the sack, it's the sack credit. Good job by him. Chester tried to roll out to his right, unable to avoid it. Tried to do the stiff arm, and it just wasn't happening. And so 3 and out quickly for the Lynx.
So Riley Ripper backed up onto his own goal line for the punt here. Cougars return man at the 50-yard line. There's the punt. And it's going to be a fair catch called for by the Cougars on the Lynx 46-yard line. So that's where the Cougars will start their first possession here in the second half. with 12:43 to go.
Nate Carson calling for that fair catch. We'll see who comes on out for the Cougars. That will be the backup quarterback, Clay Cenarius. You know, you call it a backup quarterback.
They've just kind of been rotating in and out.
They've been rotating in and out. They're both, Matt Crable and Clay Cenarius, both 6'4". They could be tight ends on different teams if they wanted to be. These are big boys, a big team.
You're not wrong, Sean. There's a handoff to number 24, Martell Williams, and he's going to get brought down just shy of the first down markers. As they're going to call it gain of 8, so 2nd and 2 for the Cougars.
Yeah, he did a very good job of moving outside, trying to get outside the numbers as well, but the Lynx did a good job wrapping that up on the outside. A good job. The Lynx run game has been, except for one or two runs that have broken out for big ones, they've done a very good job on the run game.
Talking about the Lynx rush defense there?
Yes, the defense. The Lynx. But that one, I mean, that's considerably one of the higher runs that they've given up so far in the game without being a big score.
Cenarius fakes the handoff. He's got time to pass, and he's going to drop it off to number, I can't tell what number that is, Sean. Is that 24?
Yeah, 24 again.
Martell Williams. So that's going to be a loss of yards on the play. So good job by the Lynx.
One thing I wanted to note. Oh, go ahead. Sorry.
I was just going to say, well covered by the Lynx on all aspects.
You know what? One thing, number 56, I noticed on that play, Lance Winkler. He was going after the tackler, Martell Williams. He was going after Williams, but Williams made one move, and then Winker just kind of gave up on the play. You didn't see him run back in the play on that. You know, you wish you'd see that. I understand what the score is, but that's something you can coach upon, I guess.
Cenarius dropping back to pass, and he's going to get sacked, brought down by number 51 and 87 on the Lynx.
Yeah, Mason Carr got in there, did a very good job of doing so.
And Hunter DeLone's also there for the Lynx.
And so with that play there, that is the first time, I think, all afternoon that the Cougars have gone 3 and out. So the Lynx doing a very good job there defensively on that stand.
Yep, this will be the first punt of the afternoon for the Cougars. Back deep to receive for the Lynx is number 3, Avery Andrews.
They only gained a yard on that whole series. So good job there by the Lynx.
Absolutely. High snap. There's the punt. It's going to be a short punt. It is going to take a Cougar roll as they're going to down that inside the 10-yard line.
You know, yeah, very good grab there by the Cougars player. That ball could have rolled out, bounced honestly all the way to the end zone, but they got snagged up pretty quickly just before it could do so. It's going to be down about the 9-yard line. So the Lynx get a little bit of a favorable bounce,
sure,
a little bit favorable grab, I should say.
Because they could have let that roll a little bit further.
Yeah.
Tell you what, Sean, it's, you know, 1st and 10 for the Lynx, ball in their own 9, backed up pretty far into their own zone here. However, now I think it'd be a great time, because I think they're going to be expecting a run here. I'd throw a quick slant across the middle here, try to open up that middle of the field, and hand off to Bogans Love. He's going to run straight ahead for a minimal gain. I think it's hard to tell from here. Maybe they're going to give him a gain of 1.
Yeah, probably a gain of 1. I'd like to see the Lynx as well try that deep ball once again that they've done on the left side, on the far side of the field where they have been moving from left to right. They've gotten 2 good looks with it, and they build off their only touchdown of the game based on that throw as well. Could have potentially had another one if the flag came in. But Chester's done a very good job, and it looks like the Cougars aren't just ready for those deep plays.
Chester tosses it off to Owens. He's going to run off right side and get brought down for gets right back to the line of scrimmage. Yep, no gain on the play, so 3rd and 8 for the Lynx. Ball on their own 12-yard line.
Yeah, Blake Schumacher, the junior, with great gap coverage, trying to go outside the numbers there, was the Lynx running back. But he did a very good job of closing that gap, not allowing him to get any yards. Could have potentially been a loss as well for the Lynx, but nonetheless, it's just a loss of a play. since there's no yards gained, no yards lost.
It's third and eight for the Lynx. Chester awaiting the snap. There's a snap. Hands it off to Owens. He's going to run straight ahead for a gain of two. So it's going to bring up fourth and six for the Lynx.
Now, I was hoping the Lynx would throw the ball down the field. I mean, there's three straight running plays in a row, and the Lynx, running-wise, on running plays when they run back-to-back, have not been successful.
Yeah, I don't know, Sean, if maybe their mindset was maybe just try to get a couple extra yards and have Riley Ripper a little bit more room to work with back there. So if that's the case, then they did succeed by gaining a couple extra. There's the snap. Ripper's punt is up. It's a high one, and it's going to be fair caught by number 15 on the Cougars at about the Lynx 40-yard line. You got any score updates there, Sean?
You know, I haven't been looking. It's 8:08 to go in the third quarter of our game here. Lynx trail 48-7. Let me take a look at some of the scores that have been happening. I know Georgia and Florida has just started. We'll see what happens in that game. If that gets conspires here. Georgia up 10-0.
This throw is thrown into the... Yes, scenarios rolled out to his right and pass was complete to Jordan Schmeling. For enough for a first down, looks like the refs are going to move the chain, so game looks like about exactly 10 on the play.
Maryland's up 7-3 on Illinois. Arizona State, USC tied at 7. Iowa is up 5-0 on Penn State.
5-0.
5-0.
That's an odd score.
A safety and a field goal.
Number 24, Martell Williams on the carry. It's going to be a gain of 5, so bring up 2nd and 5.
Oklahoma up 7-0 on Kansas State. Number 8th ranked Oklahoma.
Looks like, excuse
University of South Florida. Number 21 ranked University of South Florida losing 14-0 against Houston so far.
So Cenarius dropping back to pass, and the Lynx were there because he was getting ready to get sacked, but
got rid of it just in time. Clemson did beat FSU 59-10.
Close one.
Yeah, very close game there. Not really.
So Martell Williams' rush a few plays ago was actually a gain of 3, not 5. So it's 3rd and 7. Ball on the Lynx 26-yard line. 7:15 to go here in the third quarter.
They've extended plays and they've moved the chains once so far. Let's see if the quarterback can do it here for the.
Scenarios dropping back. It's looking down the middle of the field, and pass is going to be intercepted by the Lynx. So they're out across to the 20, 30, to the 40. He's got some blockers. He's out across midfield. He's still going. He's going to get brought down at the 40. That was number 25, Tre'Shaun Bell, with the interception.
You know, that is very good athleticism right there by the Lynx. Cornerback Tre'Shaun Bell, because that ball was even tipped out of the hands. There are flags on the play.
It was.
This is after the reception, though. After the interception, I should say. The interception's going to stand.
It was all around a good defensive play by the Lynx. You had rushers going up the middle, putting pressure on the quarterback. The ball was tipped by, I believe, number 56, Lance Winkler. Don't hold me to that. So it is going to be a legal block below the waist there on Lindenwood on the interception return. So it's going to be a 15-yard penalty from the spot of that foul. But either way, the Lynx do have the ball after the interception.
And that really upsets. That's a bad penalty to take because that really hurts after the fact the interception happens. I mean, we're talking about Tre'Shaun Bell being down at the 40, around the 40-yard line in Cougar territory.
Sure.
And now we're back all the way to where the foul was spotted, which was around the 45-yard line in Lynx territory. Then add 15 tack onto that. You're now at the 30-yard line of the Lynx.
Sure.
Ball's being spotted at the 32.
It is quite the flip of field position,
yeah.
But... if they don't make that interception.
You're losing a difference of 30 yards on that. So, but the Lynx, they got to make up for that. They got to.
Sure, and maybe the offense used that as a boost there. And take a shot down the field? Or
there's only two wide receivers out.
Chester fakes the handoff to Bogans Love. He's going to go across the middle. Two Bogans Love passes, complete for a first down. He's out across the 50 and gets brought down inside Cougar territory. We'll call it the 36-yard line. So he faked the handoff to Bogans Love and then went right back to him for the completion.
That is a great play call. It shows why I'm not a coach and I have no interest in football background whatsoever. But, you know, there was only two wide receivers out available for that play. Play action split on both sides. Sure. And Bogans Love gives the play action, takes the pass, and has all that opening down the field. And he really took advantage of the play, being tackled around where the Lynx initially lost
the play. Chester takes a shot down the field. Pass is complete to Candelaria for a touchdown for the Lynx. And, Sean, we've seen that play earlier in the first half a couple times, and Chester went right back to it. Candelaria had a step on his on the defensive back and led him right to it and dropped right in for a Lynx touchdown.
That is the shortest play of the season, I think, I've seen. I haven't done much Lynx games this season, only been doing this one, but that is the shortest play drive that I've seen. Two plays, that's all it took. And they moved 70 yards down the field for the touchdown.
So 48-13 Cougars, barring the extra point here for Ripper. There's a snap. Kick is up. Kick is blocked. But it's going to get picked up by Avery Andrews, and he's going to get tackled. So the PAT is blocked, so score will remain 48-13 Cougars over the Lynx with 6:21 to go here in the third quarter. We're going to take a quick commercial break here. We get back. More second half football from Cougars and the Lynx.
Every day in America, over 115 people die due to opioid abuse, including prescription pain relievers, heroin, and synthetic opioids such as fentanyl. It is estimated that 4-6% of Americans who misuse prescription pain relievers transition to heroin. Don't become a statistic. Flush away your prescribed pain pills as soon as you don't need them anymore. These statistics are brought to you by drugabuse.gov.
And welcome back to Lindenwood Stadium, where the Lynx just had a two-play, 70-yard touchdown drive as it was capped off on a touchdown reception from Candelaria from Chester on a great play. So the Lynx have chipped away in this deficit. And the score right now is 48-13 with 6:21 to go. So Riley Ripper out to kick off for the Lynx. Back deep to receive for the Cougars is number one. There's the...
Thank you.
So 6:20 to go here in the third quarter. The Cougars are going to take over on their own 30-yard line.
How about a pick six right here?
I'll just take a defensive touchdown any way we can get it.
Agreed.
So the Lynx defense back out onto the field. Cougars offense got three receivers to the right, one to the left. Cenarius hands the ball off. Number 24, Martell Williams, is going to hop off left side and get run out of bounds at the 40-yard line. Williams run out of bounds by number 16 on the Lynx, Gavon Burks.
Cougars trying to kill that clock. They're trying to run the ball because the clock right now is their friend. Yeah, they're up 48-13, but the quicker they can the longer that they can get that clock moving, the quicker they'll be out of here with the victory. And the Lynx is trying to find some way to get a loose ball or something.
So second and one for the Cougars. Hands off to Martell Williams again. He's going to have enough for a first down. He's going to rumble forward. Crosses the 45-yard line. They'll make it about the 47. Brought down by number three, Avery Andrews, who continues to have a great game defensively for the Lynx.
That clock continues to run. All right, 5:40 here in just a few seconds. As of right now,
So it's going to be first and 10 for the Cougars. Ball in their own 46-yard line scenario, so awaiting the snap. There's the snap. Hands off to Williams. It's going to go off right side. And the Lynx are going to be there to bring him down for a loss on the play. That was number 57 on the Lynx. Christian Miller.
We got some pushing and shoving after the play. I mean, you know, the score speaks for itself. The Lynx got a big mountain to climb, but that's still... They still got the heart out there that they're pushing. They're pushing out. They're not letting the Cougars get in their faces.
Still giving it their all.
Still giving it their all. Yeah.
So looks like second and 10. So he got back to the line of scrimmage. Second and 10, 46-yard line. Under 5 minutes to go in the third. There's a snap. Hands off to Williams. He's gonna run straight ahead. Dive forward for a gain of 3. It's gonna bring up 3rd and 7. For the Cougars.
Trying to go up the middle of the hole, trying to get the holes there. But the Cougars have had a tough time doing that. Occasionally they'll get the run up the middle. But majority it's been the Lynx that have done a very good job of shutting those gaps down.
So 3rd and 7, ball in the 48-yard line. Scenario's got 2 receivers left, 2 split to the right. Williams in the backfield. There's a snap. He's driving back to pass, looking across the middle of the field. And he's got, it didn't look like him and the receiver were on the same page as he threw it to nobody. So it's going to bring up 4th down for the Cougars as the Lynx hold them on 3rd down.
God, you wish if somebody, one of the Lynx players was there that could have gotten that interception, maybe even run it back the other way for a touchdown. But nonetheless, they draw a punt.
Another great stand by the Lynx defense here. So it's 4th and 7, ball on the 48. Back deep to receive for the Lynx, number 3, Avery Andrews. There's the snap. Punt is up. Good punt for the Cougars. Avery Andrews is going to call for a fair catch. He hauls that in inside the 15-yard line.
Hey, Bob. Bobbled it for a little bit, but maybe didn't get the catch on that he wanted. But he snagged it up nonetheless, and so the Lynx, with a second off of 4 minutes, they'll have see if they can get in one more score before the end of the quarter.
So while we have a stoppage in play here, we'll look at the upcoming schedules for both teams. First for Lindenwood, they have 2 games left on the schedule after today. They travel to 21st ranked Siena Heights in Adrian, Michigan, and then at second-ranked Marion University in the season, which is in Indianapolis. Both games are at 1 o'clock. For St. Francis, after today, they have 1 game remaining, and that's at Taylor University. Chester hands off to Owens. He's going to run off right side and get brought down about the 15-yard line.
And in my opinion, the Lynx just cannot afford to run the ball. They don't have the time to do it. Every time they run the ball, they're going to lose some precious time on that clock to come back in this football game.
I will say, though, Chester's looked good today throwing the ball.
The receivers have had
a step or two on the secondary.
I think they need to keep doing that. They need to keep throwing the ball as Chester looks over to his sideline. I'll get you a second to eat that cookie there. Here, I'll take the play from here. Chester in the gun. He's got his receiver onto his right side. He'll hand it on off to him, or running back, I should say, and trying to go up the middle. No can do. A bunch of Cougar players there, and after the whistle is blown, the runner Jaquan Owens just got tossed to the ground. No flag. You know, I gotta question the officiating here. I mean, that you've given the Lynx 5 unsportsmanlike conduct penalties in this game, and there's an instance for an unsportsmanlike conduct, and you don't throw the flag.
Yeah, you're exactly right, Sean. I was expecting a flag there on the play also.
So Chester in the gun once again. A pair of receivers out there, one on each side. Owens in the backfield, play action. Chester looking deep downfield again. He has the man wide open and just knocked down. A flag is called. And it'll be pass interference. And to be perfectly honest, I believe that is a makeup call on that no call on sportsmanlike conduct, because personally, I thought it wasn't worthy of a call. But nonetheless, the Lynx catch a break there.
And yeah, we'll take that. And, you know,
as I said in the first half, that touchdown before the second half started chipping away. And, you know, added another touchdown, and here are the Lynx driving down again, you know, chipping away.
I didn't see much pass interference there, to be perfectly honest, but the Lynx do catch a break.
They didn't get a pass interference earlier when they should have gotten it. It wasn't a sportsmanlike conduct when there should have been, potentially, but the Lynx get on there.
The intended receiver on that throw was Peter Smith for the Lynx. Not any relation to you, I'm sure, Chris Smith.
No relation to me.
So it is first and 10. Pair of receivers on both sides. There's going to be a handoff right up the middle to Owens. Runs up, gets about maybe 4 yards on the play. Gains actually 3 with 2:15 to go in this third quarter. The Lynx trailing the Cougars 48-13. But they have the ball and a little bit of momentum. Chester looking on over to his sidelines. Now checking his sleeve book. And gets in the gun, and Owens is just to his left. Man in motion. Chester looking on the field. He hits the throw intended for number 10.
That's Mitch Peters on the reception.
Peters on the reception gets the grab around the 40-yard line and maybe the 39, and they rule that he was at the 40. So that's where the ball will be spotted. Third and 3 here for the Lynx with 90 seconds to go in the quarter.
So Chester's getting the play from the sideline. He's got 2 receivers to the left, 2 to the right. Owens in the backfield.
Owens to his left.
There's the snap. Chester
rolls out to his right with his left to the throw. Gets the first down completed. And a very good job working inside the hash marks there. Inside the pocket line, I should say. Advances Lynx first down into Cougar territory. And this is a different Lynx team we have seen in the second half.
It sure is, Sean. And like we just said, they've been passing the ball great, you know, the majority of the game. So keep going to it. Keep going to the air with it, you know.
Absolutely. Clock ticking here. It's continuing to tick. Play clock at 18. Game clock to 40 seconds to go.
Chester looks like he's got the play from the sideline. He's got 2 receivers to the right, Mitch Peters and Ricardo Henry. 2 receivers to the left, Owens to his left in the backfield. Fakes the handoff. He's dropping back. He's going across the middle, and I'm not sure if him and the receiver were on the same page, but either way, pass is incomplete. Bring up second down, and the clock does stop for the Lynx.
You know, on that play, looking to go over the middle, the intended receiver knew where he was supposed to go, but the defenseman lineman right there in the area just got caught up in his trail path and wasn't allowing him the access to go there. And, you know, that just happens sometimes. But fortunately for the Lynx, that was not intercepted with 27.2 to go.
And the clock did stop, so obviously the clock not on the Lynx side at the moment. So second and 10 for the Lynx, ball in the Cougars 48. Chester dropping back to pass. He's looking downfield. Passes complete to Henry across the middle. He's going to be brought down by number 56 on the Cougars.
Yeah, he was looking to go a little bit deeper downfield. The Lynx not going to take a timeout here. They're going to let the clock run. Potentially, that's going to be the last play of the quarter. Over the middle, Henry with the catch, the reception. Didn't get as many yards as he'd hoped. That'll be 3rd and 5 for the Lynx as they'll move from right to left to start the fourth quarter.
Yep, so that's going to end the third quarter. Got 1 quarter left here at Lindenwood Stadium on homecoming day. Beautiful day here in Belleville. We're going to take a quick commercial break here. The St. Francis University Cougars out of Indiana lead Lindenwood Belleville 48-13. We'll be right back for the fourth quarter after this commercial break.
Here at Lindenwood Belleville, being in the Mass Communications and Broadcasting Department gives you the ability to have hands-on experience. The radio station is student-run, where you, the student, are able to produce and air your own show. Besides shows, Lindenwood gives you the ability to do play-by-play for sporting events. All this is basically like an internship itself, as it gives you the hands-on experience as you would receive at a job. This is all possible on KCLC HD3, St. Charles, Belleville.
Are you interested in producing media or marketing? Do you have any media-based ideas but haven't found a way to put it to use? Media Club is looking for someone like you. Media Club's goal is to create and support a culture where students are able to develop and practice their professional and creative goals with opportunities to publish, display, and present their work throughout the campus and community. Media Club would love for you to join if you have an interest in any of the following: storytelling, photography, graphic design, advertising, publishing, television, writing, acting, radio, video, news, or art. So, if you are interested in joining, show up to one of our Monday meetings at 2:30 in C100. Or you can contact Justin Edgren at jedgren@lindenwood.edu.
Back to Lindenwood Stadium. While we were still at commercial break, Chester to Candelaria for a Lynx touchdown. So score is out 48-19. And I tell you what, Sean, we saw that play earlier in the game too, and Chester went right back to it, which was about the same play as he did on the other end of the field, just flip sides. And so the Lynx continue to chip away at the deficit, as it is now 48-19, 9 seconds.
You know what? Go for two right here. Just go for it.
They are out there for the two-point conversion, Sean.
Absolutely. That's what I like to see. Take your chances. Looking for a quick slant to the right.
Chester awaiting the snap. Floor is in motion. Fakes handoff to Owens. He's going to look to the end zone, and it's going to be
intercepted.
So
a flag. A flag on the play.
Is that possibly a late hit?
That is a late hit on the quarterback. This will get redone here. Yep.
So it looks like it is going to be roughing the passer.
Now this can be done to where it'll be going the kickoff. Maybe potentially. And they can line up and retry it again. If that's a...
So they are going to go half the distance to the goal and redo the try. So
my opinion on a play like that, instead of half the distance to the goal, put the ball right on the one.
Not a bad way to look at that.
That's not a bad way to look at it. I don't like these half the distance to the goal penalties. On penalties like those, you should put it right to the one. And if there's a penalty anywhere beyond, then you put half the distance to the goal.
Sure. But there's a snap. Chester rolling out to his right. He's going to look across the left side, and pass is going to be incomplete. Not sure if the pass was intended for number 41, William Arnt. I'm not sure, Sean, if there may have been contact before the ball got there or not. But either way, 48-19, Cougars over the Lynx as the Cougars continue to chip away. As we are 9 seconds into the fourth quarter at Lindenwood Stadium. We'll just stay right here, Sean. And
Sure, why not?
They're giving away the baskets here.
I didn't buy a ticket, so I don't buy a ticket.
I'm going to win.
I did not buy a ticket. I don't carry much cash.
Well, at least you know you're not going to win.
I know that, yeah. Maybe if nobody claims one, I can get my hand in there. But I doubt that.
If I'd known there were baskets up there, I would have thrown something in.
Really? I mean, I know what was in the basket.
All I know is
cookies or
this week
food, fruit.
The week just didn't go on my side for, you know, winning stuff. I didn't win the Mega Millions.
Oh man, I didn't either.
And I didn't win the Queen of Hearts thing. I didn't, you know, this week either. And someone did draw the Queen of Hearts. But Ripper out for the kick. It's going to be fielded at about the 25-yard line by the Cougars, and he's just going to take a knee at the 25.
I'm curious as to why he took the fair catch in the knee when there was not a Lynx player within 10 yards. You know, now the Cougars, they face a little adversity here. Giving up.
A bold observation there, Sean.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. You know, that's what we get paid to do. Well, we don't get paid very, though, do we? You know, we get. But, you know,
So it's first and 10 for the Cougars, ball on their own 22-yard line.
You know, as I was saying, the Cougars have faced a little adversity in the second half, and they're still going to throw the ball. I'm surprised.
Yeah, as you said, they did throw the ball. Pass complete to number 7, Dan Rixey. This is going to be enough to move the chains, so first down for the Cougars. Ball be placed the 35-yard line. Clock now moving, 14:30 to go in the game. Each team with all their timeouts remaining. Looks like Matt Crable is back into the game for the Cougars.
Expect this is going to be a run. I'll play action. I take that back.
Fakes the handoff, throws to number 7, Rixey, and he's going to go off left side, gets around defender, and he's going to have enough for another first down for the Cougars. So back-to-back completions from Crable to Rixey for back-to-back first down plays.
Yeah, Rixey did a very good job of catching the ball and getting the first down, avoiding a few tackles on that play.
So they're going to call it the 46-yard line.
Still on the Lynx have a little bit of adversity themselves here in this second half.
Crable rolling out to his right. He's going to look downfield. Looked like there was a hold, but no penalty, and Crable's just going to throw it out of bounds. As the Lynx defense had good coverage on the Cougars, and looks like
all
the refs are
really need to be, and we got some more. Pushing and shoving and some jawing between the teams.
Looks like the refs are going to just get them separated without having to throw any flags here. So that's a good sign. So it's going to bring up second down and 10 for the Cougars after the incomplete pass. Pick six here would be nice, Sean.
Yeah, it'd be tough. Had a long way to go for the pick six, but hey,
anything's possible.
Hand off to Martell Williams. It's going to go straight forward to about the 48-yard line, so gain of 2.
Mason Carr in there on the tackle for the Lynx, number 51. And here comes the train.
You know, I never see many trains on this track next to the football field. They're all on that other side.
Yeah, they're on the other side. If you're just joining us, the campus has 2 sets of train tracks on both the south and the north ends of the campus that run through the campus. So one running right by the ball, our football field here.
3rd and 7. He's got all the time in the world to throw. And he's going to... Crable's pass intended for number 6, Rocky James, was incomplete. He had a lot of time to throw, but...
Gabon Burks had a chance to intercept that football. Instead, he chose to bat it away. A good play either way. I would have taken the interception, though. Maybe he was from our angle, maybe he was too far away, had to bat it down. Good play defensively. It would have been a first down and then some.
Interception would have been nice, but hey, they held him on 3rd down, brings up 4th down, and Link's going to get the ball here. So...
let's see what happens.
Back deep.
A block punt here.
It'd be nice. Back deep to receive for the Lynx, number 20, Troy Owens. There's a snap. Punt is up. Good punt for the Cougars as Owens barely has to move to catch it. And he's going to call for a fair catch at about the 10-yard line. So we're going to take a quick 30-second commercial break here. When we get back, the Lynx will be on offense on their own 10-yard line.
It all started.
Lindenwood Belleville Television.
LBTV, where you can catch the latest student broadcasts from talk shows to radio shows. Find out what's going on in the area and around campus every Wednesday on LBTV News. Channel 12.7 on campus or 989 on Charter Spectrum. Tune in now and see what makes Lindenwood like no other.
Welcome back to Lindenwood Stadium. The Lynx are back on offense here. Chester flips the ball out to Jaquay Owens. And looks like it's going to be a loss of yards on the play. But
the Lynx defense has been playing really well here in the second half and has been getting the Lynx offense back onto the field here.
That they have. They have been doing a very good job offensively in the second half, the Lynx have.
See if it continues here with this drive. However, they are deep in their territory.
So it is going to be, looks like a loss of 7 yards on the play. So second and 17 for the Lynx. Clock ticking. 12:15 to go in the game. Chester awaiting the snap. He's got two receivers to the left. Fakes the handoff. He looks to his left. Pass intended for Ricardo Henry, but well coverage on the play were the Cougars.
Went in and out of the fingertips of Henry. Would have loved to see a grab there, but just couldn't come up with it.
So it's going to bring up 3rd and 17 for the Lynx. Cougars lead 48-19. Lynx do have all three timeouts remaining if they do need to burn one at any point here in the fourth quarter. Chester, two receivers split to the right, two receivers to the left. Owens in the backfield. St. Francis not showing blitz. Pass is incomplete.
He was open too, number.
Nazaragwe was the intended receiver. He was wide open, would have had the first down had the catch been made, but out of the reach and arm's length away. And three and out for the Lynx here. They'll be punting from the back of their end zone.
So we'll see if Ripper can have a big punt here as he is back deep in his own end zone. There's a snap. Punt is up. Punt is blocked, and it's out the back of the end zone. So that's going to be a safety for the Cougars. So it's going to be 50-19, and the Lynx will be back to have some kickoff duties here, so Ripper will be right back onto the field. But, Sean, that could have been worse because that ball could have not went out the back of the end zone. They could have recovered that in the end zone for a touchdown.
Could have. Even if the Lynx receded or not in that end zone, it would have been a safety anyway. 2 points off the board. Not the worst outcome for the Lynx, but it's certainly one you don't want to see.
So 11:55 to go here in the game. Get you caught up on, we have a minute here, get you caught up on the overall series between the two teams. Today marks the fourth meeting between the Lynx and the Cougars. The Lynx are 0-3 in their previous meetings with the Cougars. St. Francis University is located in Fort Wayne, Indiana.
Been there a couple years ago. Went on the trip. Got a nice facility, nice stadium over there in St. Francis.
Do have a quick score update here for you, Sean.
All right.
12th ranked Kentucky leads Mizzou. This game is at Mizzou, 3-0, 2 minutes till the end of the first quarter. So, real high scoring game there down in Columbia, Missouri. So,
that's sarcasm.
So, Riley Ripper out for the punt after the safety or kickoff slash punt.
Well, he had to punt it because the ball wouldn't stick on the thing. So, is gathered in by number 86 of the Cougars. Took a knee when he caught a Kyle May, the tight end.
Let's see what we got here. Sean, Florida, 9th ranked, trails 7th ranked Georgia, 10-7. Vanderbilt was the winner today over Arkansas, 45-31 in the SEC. And 18th-ranked Iowa leads 17th-ranked Penn State 12-7.
How about that World Series game last night?
Wild.
You stayed up to watch all Bellinger, 18 innings of that one. You were in for a thriller. I fell asleep, so.
So Crable going to run with it, and he's going to get brought down after a short game. We'll call it a gain of 2. Tell you what, Sean, did you see Bellinger's throw?
I did.
Out at home.
I did.
Oh my cannon!
He threw a very good throw there. I mean, I think I saw somewhere that somebody said that nobody's as strong with as fast or just as good of a ball player as Cody Bellinger. And I had to say to myself, does this boy not see Mike Trout play?
Shades of Rick Ankiel, maybe.
Possibly.
So second and seven for the Cougars. Cradle dropping back to pass. He's looking to the right. Pass is going to be complete to number 11.
That is good enough for a first down. A good catch there by Will Chrisman. He ran out of bounds, or was pushed out of bounds, but it's good enough for a first down. I got a great look at it. Just happened just in front of us. Here in our broadcast position.
So it's going to be enough for a first down. So they're going to, we'll call it the 47-yard line. As we tick under 11 minutes to go here in the game. Crable waiting the snap. Two receivers to the left. And he's going to
keep it himself.
Keep it himself. And he's got some running room. He's got enough for a first down. And he's going to get brought down. And we got a flag on the play.
It's a flag. It's probably going to be on the Cougars here. I think 59 of the Cougars. Austin Smoger did something he wasn't supposed to do as a Lynx player was down. That's where the flag spotting is. We shall see what the ref says, though. 10:44 to go on the clock.
So the ref's discussing the penalty here.
I don't think this is going to be a roughing the passer. There's a possibility it can be, but I don't believe it's going to be.
I don't either, Sean. I think it's going to be a late hit or unnecessary roughness. So it is going to be a 15-yard penalty on the Cougars, so it's going to back them up. So the first down will count since this was after the play.
So it's Austin Smoger was the one that got the penalty. Yeah, he did it right.
I was right on that. Great observation, Sean. Nice job.
Thanks, Chris.
So first and 10 for the Cougars. Mm.
Good tackle there by the Lynx player, Trayshawn Bell. He looked like he tried to strip the ball from the receiver, Dan Rixey. Christian Miller on the tackle as well.
So Cougars close to Lynx territory here. So they're going to be on their own 49-yard line. Second and six. Crable, three receivers split to the right, none to his right. Fakes the handoff. Pass complete to number seven, Dan Rixey. And he's trying to stretch for the first down, but I think the officials are going to spot him just short there, Sean.
Yeah, you can see that play happening again. They did it previously in the last quarter where they had three wide receivers on that right side and that one dropped back behind the two. So that way you can get a little bit of the blockers in there. Rixey was as well the receiver last time that caught the ball and catches it again here. Looking for the same type of play, but the Lynx were not fooled.
So it's going to be third and a long one, it looks like, for the Cougars. Hand off to Martell Williams. He's going to have enough for a first down. He's off left side. He's going to get tripped up after he crosses the 40-yard line, so they're going to mark it down at the 39. Clock stop while they reset the chains here. Clock now ticking as we approach 9 minutes to go in the game. First and 10 for the Cougars. Crable's got two receivers to the right. Fakes the handoff. He's going to look downfield. He's going to go towards the end zone. He's got a guy, and it's going to be a touchdown. That's that Rixey for a Cougar touchdown. Crable to Rixey with 8:48 to go in the game. Cougars add on another score here to make it 56-19.
Rixey found that opening in the middle of downfield and took advantage of it. Took the pass, took the catch, took it to the house.
So number 87, Gavin Garner back onto the field. He has been doing the kicking duties today for the Cougars. Waiting the snap. Snap is there. Kick is up. Kick is good. So it's going to be 57-19. Cougars over the Lynx with 8:48 to go. We're going to step aside for a quick break here. When we get back, the Lynx will be on offense. Be right back. We'll be at Lindenwood Stadium.
Hey everybody, this is Sydney Sickness. Make sure you tune in to 89.1 The Link every Friday from 9 to 11 for Caught in a Mosh. The 89.1 The Link's only metal reviews, news, and interview show where heavy metal is the law. Remember, that's Friday from 9 to 11 on 89.1 The Link for Caught in a Mosh. Horns high, my friends.
Welcome back to Lindenwood Stadium here on homecoming day. Beautiful day out, Sean, for homecoming here.
Yeah, it's been, the weather we've had the last 2 days of rain and overcast. Today the sun is peeking through here and a few clouds in the sky, but it's been very nice.
Cougars kicking off. Ricardo Henry's going to take a knee in the end zone for a touchback. So the Lynx will take over on their own 25-yard line. So with 8:48 to go here in the game, the Lynx have it on their own 25-yard line, trailing 57-19. Lynx offense back out on the field. Chester's got two receivers to his left, Owens in the backfield, and two receivers to his right.
Look for Chester to go deep here again. I feel like he knows that he can and will again.
6 seconds on the play clock. There's a snap. Hands it off to Owens. And he's going to have positive yards there, but it looked like for a second, Sean, he was going to have no gain or a loss of yards possibly on the play.
Would have loved to have seen a flea flicker right there, because that would have totally caught the Francis Cougars off guard.
Sure would have, Sean.
It would. I mean, why not? I mean, Lynx, this is the time to do it. I mean, you're down. Probably not going to win this football game, but you're down. You have chances. You have opportunities to try something new, get some life on the sidelines.
Chester dropping back to pass. Pass will be complete to number 10. That's Mitch Peters.
I mean, if you look at the sideline for the Lynx, I mean, there are guys sitting down, and half of the guys are sitting down, the other half standing up. Let's get some life. I know you're trailing by this much, but get some life going in there. Make some trick plays happen. They'll get some life and something to look forward to build off of. There's something to practice and practice.
Sure.
Maybe potentially with the trick plays, the trickery.
So it's going to be 3rd and 3 for the Lynx, ball on their own 32. Hand off to Owens. And he's going to run straight forward. It looks like he will have enough for a first down. So that's going to be a Lynx first down there as the chains are moving. Clock does stop as they have to reset the chains. So it's going to be 1st and 10 for the Lynx. So we tick under 7.5 minutes to go. Ball will be on the 36-yard line. Chester getting the play from the sideline. Lynx offense had 4 receivers out there. Owens in the backfield. Chester dropping back. He's looking downfield. Pass is complete to Peters, and he's going to have enough
flag
for a first down. But
roughing the passer, it's going to be called here on the Cougars.
Is that number 45 for?
Yeah, number 45 for the Cougars is going to get the penalty. Devin Green, the senior. He was apologetic for it, but still the penalty is called. And so after the run.
So big penalty there on the Cougars, which is going to help the Lynx get into Cougar territory.
Lynx had the first down anyway, and now they tack on 15 more after that.
And, you know, Sean, as we were looking at their roster, you know, looking for number 45, if you go up one name to number 44, you got a guy on their team named Chris Smith.
How about that?
Look at that.
I noticed that when I was looking at the two deeps. Chris Smith in our broadcast booth. He could be in two places at once.
That takes some skill.
That would.
So 1st and 10 for the Lynx.
You're not Jesus, I don't think.
First and 10 for the Lynx, ball on the Cougar 39-yard line. Lynx driving. Chester in. We got some whistles. There is a flag on the play. I'm not sure if it was a delay of game.
False start.
Oh, timeout.
Okay. I think the delay of game was approaching, and the Lynx coaching staff noticed that and called timeout. We're going to take a quick 30-second commercial break here. We'll get back. Lynx driving in Cougar territory. We'll be right back.
Here at Lindenwood Belleville, being in the mass communications and broadcasting department gives you the ability to have hands-on experience. The radio station is student-run, where you, the student, are able to produce and air your own show. Besides shows, Lindenwood gives you the ability to do play-by-play for sporting events. All this is basically like an internship itself, as it gives you the hands-on experience as you would receive at a job. This is all possible on KCLC HD3, St. Charles.
Hey, welcome back to Lindenwood Stadium here. Lynx trailing the Cougars 57-19. However, the Lynx are driving in Cougar territory. They have a first down ball on the Cougar 39-yard line. There's the snap, fakes the handoff to Owens. Chester is going to pass it off to Owens. He's got some running room. He's going to get brought down after a gain of about five, so. Maybe about second and five.
Nick Lucas with the tackle.
Did a very good job. Owens of getting the ball and getting some yardage.
As the sun peeking out even more into our broadcast booth.
I tell you what, I feel sorry for anybody across the way because it's reflecting right off my terrible receding hairline at the moment.
I wouldn't say that.
There's the snap. Chester pass complete to Candelaria. So it's going to be a gain of positive yards there. So we're about third and three, third and two. Sean, either way, if the Lynx don't get this here, I would assume this is four down territory.
Yeah, you got to think so. Despite what the score may be, you got nothing to lose going with that approach. Five, 10 remaining in this game.
So third and three for the Lynx. And it looks like,
yeah, timeout call by the running back Owens.
So he saw that clock was quickly
at zero almost.
Well, so it looks like they're not going to give a timeout there to the Lynx, so it's going to be a delay of game.
Well, that's a backbreaker.
So it's going to be third and eight after the delay of game. So exactly 5 minutes to go here in the game. And it looks like we're going to have a timeout by the Cougars. So we're going to take a quick 30-second commercial break here. We're going to step aside. We'll be right back for the Lynx offense as they have a third down and eight. Be right back.
One of the new and exciting additions to the Lindenwood Belleville campus is the Major General William L. Enyard Veterans Success Center. There are over 100 VA students on the Belleville campus, and the Enyard Veterans Success Center provides a lounge and study space to meet and adjust to college life. It also has information about GI Bills, benefits, and available tuition assistance. It's a mini USO. For more information, call 618-239-6208 or visit belleville.lindenwood.edu.
And welcome back to Lindenwood Stadium here. Lynx offense, third and eight after the St. Francis University timeout. Exactly 5 minutes to go here in the game. Both teams do have two timeouts remaining if either of them need to burn one here in the final 5 minutes. Chester awaiting the snap. He's got two receivers to the left. That's Candelaria and Ricardo Henry. Mitch Peters to his right. Owens in the backfield. Chester dropping back to pass, and he is going to pass it. Pass is complete to Candelaria, and he's going to get brought down. But it is going to be enough for a first down there, Sean. So the sticks will move. Lynx continue the drive going and closer
That was good second effort there by the receiver Candelaria,
who tried to fend off his tackler, which he did end up doing just for a split second before the second man came in, and then he reaches for that goal, for that first down line, and he gets it.
So it's going to be first and 10 for the Lynx, 4.5 minutes to go, ball on the Cougar 26-yard line. Chester driving back to pass. Pass complete to Owens. He's got some blockers. He's got some room. He's around one. He's getting close to the end zone. He's going to dive in for a Lynx touchdown. So it's going to be 57-25, barring the extra point here, with 4:11 to go. I tell you what, Sean, that was a great effort by Owens to get into the end zone.
Got great blocks by his defensive lineman as well, and blocks from his receivers, his fellow receivers down the field. He doesn't get those blocks. There's absolutely no way he doesn't get the first down, let alone the touchdown that he just got. And maybe the Lynx go for two here again. Doesn't look like it. They're going to just get settle for the extra point potentially, unless they go for the fake.
Looks like got a new holder out on the field for this snap. That's number 51, Mason Carr. Ripper awaiting the snap. There's a snap. It's down, and it is blocked.
And this could be run
and
back the other way.
The Cougars pick it up, and who again to make the tackle? None other than Avery Andrews, who's been everywhere on the field today as he continues to have a great game. So we're going to step aside here. Cougars lead the Lynx 57-25. The Lynx will be kicking off when we return to Lindenwood Stadium.
Lindenwood Belleville Television.
LBTV, where you can catch the latest student broadcasts from talk shows to radio shows. Find out what's going on in the area and around campus every Wednesday on LBTV News. Channel 12.7 on campus or 989 on Charter Spectrum. Tune in now and see what makes Lindenwood like no other.
And welcome back to Lindenwood Stadium. Cougars lead 57-25 with 4 minutes and 11 seconds to go in the game. Lynx do have 2 timeouts remaining. Back deep to receive for the Cougars is number 1, Matt. Ripper getting ready to kick off. There's a kick. It is going to be a squib kick slash onside kick.
Oh, no.
And it is going to be recovered by the Cougars right at the 50-yard line.
I got to be perfectly honest there. That is, even though it would have been on the Lynx, there's got to be an unsportsmanlike conduct flag there. And there wasn't.
To be honest, Sean, I did not see that.
I mean, 45 has the ball. The 45, Devin Green. I haven't seen a flag be thrown.
Yeah, I don't know what you saw. I didn't see anything.
He gathered the ball, was on the ground, and a Lynx player took a late hit on him.
Oh, I thought he was still up in the air. But
I'm surprised.
That's a tricky, call to make, because if he was on the ground, he was diving for it to try to recover an onside kick. I mean, the Lynx are going to try to go after that as well. So probably, I don't know, maybe a good no ball. I don't know. But 4:08 to go here in the fourth quarter. Ball in midfield for the Cougars. New quarterback into the game for the Cougars. That's number 12, Danny Naylor.
In the I formation.
There's the handoff. Number 26, Michael Edwards. It's going to be a gain of 1 on the play. So it's going to be 2nd and 9.
I can tell you right now from the sidelines that we are very close to the St. Francis sideline. The clock's continuing to tick here, and tensions are boiling over. I wouldn't be surprised if something happens, so stick around. Might see a hockey game break out.
Never know, Sean. So it's second and nine ball on the Lynx 49-yard line. There's the handoff to Edwards. He's going to run straight ahead and get about 3 yards. And it looked like there was maybe a hold there, and they didn't call it. So it's going to be a gain of 3, third and 6 as we tick closer to 3 minutes remaining in this ball game. The Cougars have receiver to the right, two to the left, fullback in a tailback in the backfield. There's a snap, handoff, fakes the handoff to Edwards. He's going to roll off to the left. Pass is complete for a first down to number 44, Chris Smith, on the reception.
Way to go, Chris.
Yeah, I had to go out of my way to make that.
You know, with the thing was, I got to point out on that throw there by Zanarius that he is a right-handed throw, and he makes that throw with his left hand. I don't know if that's just confidence or if he's ambidextrous. Who knows?
Either way, it worked out for him.
It worked out.
Clock continuing to tick, under 2.5 minutes to go.
Unless if I've just been badly not paying attention the whole game and he has been throwing left-handed. But I don't think he's a left-handed throw.
Danny Naylor awaiting the snap. Kind of bobbled the snap, so he's just going to take it and run it himself. He's going to get smoked.
And that's going
right
to gather
out of bounds.
Some flags. That's going to gather some players. And like I said, might be a hockey game breakout here.
Yeah, there was a flag on the play, but from where we were at, you couldn't actually tell if he was out of bounds or not. And so I
led with his head potentially. Could be a targeting and out of the game.
So clock is stopped with 2 minutes and 5 seconds to go as the refs sort this one out. Here's the call by the official. Well, maybe. So it is just going to be a late hit out of bounds. So a 15-yard penalty goes against the Lynx. So that's going to tack on 15 yards for the Cougars as they are now inside the red zone.
Message sending time.
What'd you say, Sean?
Message sending time here, folks. Don't go away.
Clock now ticking as the ball's been set. Under 2 minutes to go. Naylor awaiting the snap. There's a snap. Hands off to Edwards. He's going to run straight forward. He's got some running room. He's going to hop around tackler, and he's going to get tackled after he does cross the goal line. So that's going to be a touchdown for St. Francis as they add on to their lead. Score, barring the extra point, 63 for the Cougars. Lynx 25 with a minute 47 to go. And the final home game for Lindenwood. Gardner out there to attempt the PAT. Waiting the snap. There's a snap. Kick is up. Kick is good. So the Cougars out of St. Francis University in Indiana lead Lindenwood Belleville. Lynx 64 to 25. We're going to take a quick 30-second commercial break here when we get back. Final minute 47 of the game. Be right back. You're listening.
Here at Lindenwood Belleville, being in the mass communications and broadcasting department gives you the ability to have hands-on experience. The radio station is student-run, where you, the student, are able to produce and air your own show. Besides shows, Lindenwood gives you the ability to do play-by-play for sporting events. All this is basically like an internship itself, as it gives you the hands-on experience as you would receive at a job. This is all possible on KCLC HD3, St. Charles, Belleville.
And welcome back to Lindenwood Stadium here in the final home game of the season for the Lynx as it is homecoming here on a beautiful day in Belleville, Illinois. Cougars are out to kick off, back deep to receive for the Lynx. It's Candelaria and Ricardo Henry. Candelaria is going to take the kickoff, and he's out across the 30-yard line. He's got some blockers in front, and he's going to get brought down after a great effort to cross the 30-yard line. It brought down about the 31. So, it's a minute 38 to go. You know, this may look like it might be the last offensive drive for the Lynx here on their home field for this season, so maybe they can put some points on the board here in the final drive.
Yeah, hopefully they do. I mean, that'd be a good way to send off your last game of the season here. Of course, you got two more afterwards as well, the next two weekends, but
yeah. Yeah, both on the road. Tell you what, though, this season, Sean, Lynnwood has had a tough schedule. I mean, they've faced, by the time the season ends, they will have faced five ranked opponents.
Yeah, that'll get you.
So with a minute 38 to go, the Lynx will have it on their own 31-yard line. Two timeouts remaining if they do want to use one. Chester's pass complete to Ricardo Henry. He's out across the 40-yard line. Yeah, I'm not sure how many receptions he has, Sean, but he's got to have at least double digits by now.
Yeah, at least.
So clock running, gain of 9 on the play. Minute 15 to go. Chester awaiting the snap. There's the snap. Hand off to number 33. Jordan Miller on the carry, as it is going to be enough to move the chain, so it's going to be a Lynx first down. Clock stops to reset the chains. Clock now ticking at 1 minute to go in the game. Chester awaiting the snap.
2 men in the backfield.
There's a snap. Hands off to Miller. He's going to run straight ahead. Gain about 2 yards on the play. So it's going to be second and 8. Clock's still ticking, 36 seconds. You know, with 30 seconds left, if it comes down to one play, I'd go for a Hail Mary and just let's try and see what happens here.
I don't disagree.
Chester waiting to snap there. It's a low snap, and he's just going to fall on it. So clock rolling, 13 seconds. And that looks like that is going to be the final play of the game. So the St. Francis University out of Indiana Cougars, ranked 9th in the nation, will knock off the Lynnwood Belleville Lynx here at Lynnwood Stadium with a final score of 64-25. We appreciate everybody listening all season long here from Lynnwood Stadium. The Lynx will be back in action the next 2 weeks on the road. They face 21st-ranked Siena Heights University and then end the season at 2nd-ranked Marion University. So thanks, everybody, for listening. For myself, Chris Smith, and Sean Ditch, and Professor Scott Morris, who's here all season long.
Let's not forget Drew Ryberg in the booth.
And Drew Ryberg back in the
Drew
booth.
Ryberg in the booth.
A lot of hard work behind the scenes he's done all year. So thank you for listening all season long to Lynnwood Football. Enjoy the rest of your weekend.